What do you want? Leave us alone.
Hey everybody, it's Jeff Lafferty and Jibber and Redinger, and this is Derek Cass. Mike Whitcomb is here.
We made it.
Yeah. Sorry we're late, it's entirely my fault. It's my wife's birthday today, so
That's right.
Everything was, we were partying.
Hard. We were all in that cake and milk.
Yeah, I know.
Well, I did
kind of hit the food coma there after dinner and all that, so That's part of the reason I'm late.
I feel you, dude. Like behind the scenes, I was saying I got this headache, and when you didn't hit me up, I was like, oh boy, I'm going back to bed.
Oh.
And then you right when I was going to lay down, bing.
I'm sorry.
Oh, you're getting on. No, it's all good, dude. I could have sent the message. But this is the Christmas show, man. This is the Christmas show, so we got to do it.
I figure, there probably won't be another show because Thursday is Christmas Eve, and Friday's Christmas Day.
That was probably it, man. So
yeah,
I had to make sure I got on here, even with this nasty headache. A little bit.
I thought I'd put the link out if anybody wants to come in the show.
Yeah, come on, guys. Come hang out. It's like I said, it's the Christmas show. Come hang out. Tell us what you got going on. Let's see it.
Yeah.
Talk for me so I don't have to tonight.
I thought, So I don't know who's out there, but. And I don't know. Should I just drop the link in the chat? I guess I can still.
Dangerous, but it's always fun.
Yeah.
Wait a little. Maybe wait a few minutes and see if more people drop in and throw it in there, man.
Yeah. Hmm.
I see that nice bare sheet of paper you got in front of you.
I know.
It's always good. You see, I'm just going to let this sit here probably today.
That's cool.
Yeah.
I did that redraw panel, which I forgot to post it, didn't I? It was done last night, but I didn't post it. So there's the redrawn one, which I like better. But actually, I think this one was fine, though. It's like more going on, but. Yeah. I thought I overkilled it with the white, and plus I was having my art block moment where I felt like I couldn't draw anymore.
Yeah. The only difference I see in those drawings is one has more cactuses than the other one.
Yeah. The one's more busy, but it's kind of like the top panel going across the top, so it's not a big panel. Mm-hmm. And that was part of what I didn't like about it. It seemed so busy for just like a top panel, you know? So.
Gotcha.
Nate Terry says, Merry Christmas.
Well, Merry Christmas, Nate.
Yeah, Merry Christmas to you too, dude.
I hope you have all those great Christmas miracles. Hope Santa Claus comes.
Yep. I know. I tell you, man, it's like, it's really cool here. Like, there's just this biting wind blowing through here. And it's just like intermittently is raining. So it's just kind of like blasting against my studio.
Are you enjoying that? I'm taking it. Is that what you?
It's nice. It's nice to be. No, it's good. I mean, it's nice to be inside. I damn sure wouldn't want to be outside tonight.
Yeah, I bet.
Yeah.
I mean, but you know what's nice? It's nice that I'm not in Colorado and it's not snowing and it's not that cold outside. It's about hoodie weather outside right now. I mean, I'm enjoying it.
Yeah. That's cool.
Not that I've been outside much today. Like I said, I have a feeling this headache's kind of kept me in, but the last couple of days it'll cool off kind of at night. It's like right now, man, I would almost be like, it's a Colorado summer here. You know, it's nice outside.
Colorado summer.
Yeah. But our summers are they're sweltering here though. Good 100 and something degrees, you know.
Yeah. Just
pure humidity.
Yeah.
Cut that shit with a knife.
Yeah, I don't think I'd like that, but I don't know.
No, I don't know. I do. I just didn't like that dry weather down there, man. I need this humidity.
It is. Yeah, it's even more dry now. It seems to get even drier in the winter, even though that's kind of weird. And there's like snow and stuff. Yeah. Your hands and stuff really dry out and stuff. So,
yeah, all that cold, frosty air, man. But yeah, my kids are kind of missing it though, you know, because that snow they? Around Christmas, you know, they like that. So, but you know.
Yeah, they're missing that eating the yellow snow that used to get yellow, mad at them for.
I see that Nate has them too. It says right here, is it migraine level? I have to get in a quiet, dark room and lay down. Sometimes I have to puke to feel. Y'all, dude, I puked like four times today. And I've had the headache since like 10 o'clock this morning. So it's like there, but it's at the point where it's like starting to fade away kind of, but it's still behind my right eye, killing me, man. It's definitely not what it was. Like, oh, it was so bad today. Because I have this routine. Like, if I start getting those type of headaches, dude, I like have to go vomit, instantly take a shower, and go lay back down. And it's like I'll end up doing that like two to three times a day if I have that type of headaches.
Jeez.
So, I get those sinus migraines like that, and then I get like a regular migraine that like messes with my vision. But I didn't get that. That's not what I had. I had the sinus migraine today. And you know, I'm in tip top shape here. I'm at the peak of my health, apparently. Yeah, they are no joke though, Nate. For real, dude. I've been hating life today. And in the background, I was basically like, oh, dude, I don't want to do the show. But then it was just like, you know, it's the last one before Christmas. Let's do it anyway. Because hey, it's what you gotta do.
I don't want to keep you out here be torturing you though.
Yeah, I definitely need rest, dude. I was talking to Mike Whitcomb. No, you're not torturing me, dude. I chose to come on. I'm just going to blame you and cry for a while, though. So.
That's fair.
You know, Mike Whitcomb, it sounds like you need rest. Oh, I totally do, man. I haven't even eaten today. So.
And you get up early.
Yeah, well, okay. The kids, they don't sleep in, man.
Yeah.
They don't sleep in, and my wife leaves to work early, so I got to get up with them. Until I start duct taping them and putting them in the closet, I got to get up with them.
Yeah. Well, my wife's here working, so then, you know, but my son, he actually kind of sleeps in. He sleeps in until about 10 o'clock every day. So, I don't know.
So. Yeah, you know, right now you can, man. Just imagine if they start going back to school and that whole 8 o'clock thing starts back up.
Oh,
so,
God, I know. Because I still have, all the alarms on my phone set for like when I used to have to pick him up and get him up and take him to school. And what a pain in the ass. But I don't know. But then I've noticed since he hasn't had schoolwork to do this week, I've actually been getting more stuff done because I can come out and work. Mm-hmm. When I get up, so
he's off. You had him off this week,
yeah. So he's off like this week so far, and he doesn't have to do it next week either. So he's off for 2 weeks, even though like his whole life seems to be off.
I'll probably put my kids back in school next week, they don't need to slack for too long,
yeah.
I don't. That's the problem with me because I'll start slacking, you know. And then it's just like, oh, well, we just put it off.
Yeah.
And I don't have like that Zoom call thing or whatever y'all do where y'all got to get teacher involved. I am the teacher.
Yeah.
Like dad was the first president of the United States, people. Dad. Who won the Alamo? Dad won the Alamo, kids. Dad.
They don't even mention the freaking Alamo. Like, at least we just studied that, the Mexican, what's called War with Mexico, and they didn't even fucking get into that. I was like so disappointed, you know.
Didn't get into the Alamo. They didn't talk about all these historic people like Davy Crockett.
They didn't even bring that up. All they talked about was the treaty, like the Hidalgo Treaty or whatever, and. Basically just that's it. I was like, that's super lame. So I was like adding to it and bothering Tristan with all these extra cool facts. But I mean,
They didn't even mention the Aussie pistol in the Alamo. No, I'm just kidding.
The Aussie pistol?
Ozzy Osbourne peed on the Alamo and got arrested, like in the 80s.
Oh, did he really? Yeah. I remember that when everybody, which is probably still kind of going on, but everybody's like, you know, against, like, you know, they always want to go back and rewrite history, make all the heroes the villains and the villains the heroes. And, yeah. Which they're still doing that shit. I think that's why they're just taking it out. You know, it's like, no, just don't talk about it.
Just don't talk about it. Start talking about it.
You know. Talking about it. And then we did the Civil War, which it's funny because it's like when you read the stuff. I mean, this is like something I should have told you off air, but it's like when you read it, yeah. It's like Tristan was supposed to write a report about a Spanish missionary. So you read the story about a Spanish missionary. And then it's kind of like from his diaries of like what he did. And then he was supposed to write a report about it. Not even a report, but just a paragraph of like, you know, you're a Spanish missionary. What did you do in the fort today? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so basically the Spanish missionaries, like, you know, they taught English to the Indians. They, what else did they do? They pretty much just pushed them around and, you know, tried to change their beliefs and all that shit. But then, like, Tristan wrote the report, and then I went by and I, like, looked at what he said. And then what did he say? He went and he traded a deer hide for something like he traded some pots and pans for a deer hide. And then he taught some Indians English. That's what he wrote.
That's what he wrote. There you go.
Like, oh. Which was like totally what the thing said, you know. It wasn't like, you know, he wrote what he was supposed to write, but I was just like, God, that sounds so racist. You know, but it's just dumb, though. They just want to rewrite it all. Like, I don't know. It's like they want to look at history through the lens of like whatever like political bend is going on now, you know what I mean?
Oh yeah, for sure, dude.
Because it's just completely different than when I was in school, you know. Because we were all like, because I remember, you know, when we learned like the Colorado history and stuff, and that's what basically this is.
I was like, did y'all have a class called Colorado History?
Well, they're calling it social studies, but I think it was just called like Colorado history back then.
Yeah, because we had a class, we had a Texas history class, and we went over all that stuff, man. And that was like the coolest class, dude. I was just all about it, you know.
I love that class, yeah. And but it was all about like the Plains Indians and all that kind of stuff. And then, you know, that's what was so just disappointing about it, because like when I started, you know, this year with him, and I was like, oh, cool, you're gonna love all this. And then, you know, then we're like learning about like I said, the Mexican American War or whatever they call it. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing about like any of that, like the Alamo, any of that stuff. It's all just freaking dates. I'm like, man, why would any kid want to remember this?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, you're making it lame. You're taking all the cool stories out.
Taking all the fun out of it. Yeah.
All the cool shit, man.
Man.
That's crazy. No Alamo though. That's like a big thing here.
I know. And I remember we went whenever Tanya's parents come, you know, visit, they always got to want to do some touristy thing out here in Colorado. So
they're not from Colorado?
No, they're from Reno. So out there that way. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. They're from what's it called? The only place in America where it's like legalized prostitution.
God bless them. Yeah. Doing the Lord's work.
Which is pretty funny. But they, of course, they don't have nothing to do with that. But
mm-hmm. They own the Bunny Ranch.
Yeah, right. Anyway, when they get out here, they wanted to. And this is kind of a funny story, because I remember we were supposed to go see like the Molly Brown house. Do you know like who Molly Brown is? That chick on the Titanic?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So anyway, that she lived in Denver, and she has like a mansion that's sort of like downtown Denver, like in the really shitty part of downtown, you know.
Well, what part of Denver isn't?
Exactly. When they come down, they want to go see this house, and I'm like, you want to drive to freaking downtown? And of course, it's like Friday afternoon, you know. Oh, yeah. It's the worst time ever to like brave the traffic and shit. So anyway, we drive the fuck down there. you know, park somewhere, have to pay to park, walk like 6 blocks, and the place is closed because it's like one of those deals where it's like only open like Thursday afternoons and like Wednesday from 2 to 4. And you know what I mean? Like nobody goes to see this thing. And so then we go over to, we walk across because we're now we're like right downtown. So we walk towards the museum. They have like this Colorado History Museum, which I remember this place as a kid. And it's like the same thing, it was a really cool museum like back in the day. And it was all about like the Indians, the Plains Indians, the Cheyenne, all that kind of stuff. And they had so changed it. I mean, it was, you'd never recognize it as the same place. And the whole, I mean, there was hardly anything about the Indians. They just had like a map and of like where the tribes were. And that was right at the beginning. And then it went right into like Denver's history and like the history of sort of like the different mayors. You know, they're all a bunch of freaking crooks.
You got that two-story museum with the glass back wall on it to where it like looks over the rest of downtown Denver. Do you know what I'm talking about?
I think, yeah, I think actually okay. It is. Yeah.
I've been there. Yeah, I've taken the kids there. They have a small Indian section. It's kind of upstairs. You kind of got to go upstairs and it's like kind of has like a couple of like their I guess because they didn't have teepees, they had these other things that they were building, I guess, like these almost like those little wooden homes.
Well, the ones in Colorado, at least the Plains ones, were in the teepees, but I think there was also like different tribes, you know, that did the like adobe houses and stuff. But I don't know. This might have been a different one, though. Because, like, let me ask you this. So, like, this is the part I really remember. Is they had this huge section all about this place called Five Points, which is, like, this shitty neighborhood in downtown and, like, how, like, historically important it was supposed to be. And the Ku Klux Klan. This huge thing about the fucking Ku Klux Klan here in, like, Denver.
Making Denver look good.
Yeah. And it's just like, I was like, Ku Klux Klan, when the fuck did this happen? Yeah. You know what I mean?
Well, my guess, it was probably in the 50s or maybe the 40s, Jeff. And then we're throwing that out there.
But I'm just, well, you know, I mean, I guess it could have, but I just was real fucking skeptical living here in Denver. I've never met anybody in the Ku Klux Klan. I've never seen these guys around or ran into any stories. You know what I mean?
They don't. Like do their parade in the Easter parade every year in Denver?
I mean, I don't think kidding. So.
They better not be. They get ran the hell out of it.
there might have been some stuff like that. But
now, maybe that was the same
like
that same museum. But I want to ask you a question about that museum real quick. Did it have like a huge mining area where it showed all the different rocks and it talked about all the mining and because that's the one we went to. We spent so much time in that mining area. Because my kids are so about all those rocks and stuff we were looking at, all the quartz and all the crazy stuff.
I don't know. I mean, I guess that could have been. I don't know. It might not. I don't know. Is it right like downtown, like between like those two main like streets, like trying to think what they are. I mean, it's like right almost at the Capitol. Like that's where this one is. And then there's also the History Museum, which is like a little ways away from there. That one's awesome. Like, and that's like the Natural History Museum where it's got the dinosaurs. And then upstairs, they do have like a big Indian thing. They have a big, you know, they even have like knights and armor and they have art up there and shit, you know.
Yeah. Oh, see, we did two museums like really close to each other. We did like I think it's like the History Museum. And then we did, what was the other one? We did the art museum because Rembrandt had a show. They did like a small Rembrandt showing.
Yeah,
like,
it is by that. It is near the art museum, so
it might be in.
Yeah, that is it. Yeah, they do have some good shows at the art museum. I like going over there every now and then, or I used to. I haven't been there in like 10 years, but
that was cool. Yeah. A bunch of those paintings and stuff, and yeah, you know, museums are fun. I sound refreshed, dude. I am definitely, unless you mean, like, I'm ready to go to bed, dude.
Jibber's like the walking dead today. He's got a big time headache.
Yeah, so I'm here. But hey, you want to go ahead? We were talking about throwing the link in the chat. And if y'all want to come in and hang out for a little while.
All right.
That way I don't have to do all the talking.
All right. So,
sit here and drink water.
There it goes. There's no guarantees.
Yeah, we're going to end up with people we don't know. That'd be awesome.
There's no guarantees you'll remain on once you get on, so you better be on your best behavior.
You better have clothes on. You best be wearing clothes if the camera's on you.
But yeah, if anybody wants to come in.
There it is.
So we'll see what happens.
Yeah, right. Get some names you don't know. Get some Chinese hackers in here.
I don't know if you'll have to download anything, Nate. It's StreamYards. Mm-mm. So
just go to StreamYards
click the link and see where it takes you and then see if you do or not.
Yeah, just click the link, dude. That's it.
It's like chat roulette. That's what he says. Yeah, it is.
Yeah, that's what EJB said. It is, dude. It's Christmas, man. You know, and I'm kind of beat down today. So,
yeah.
I think we're going to be doing another show this week. So, we might as well hop in and hang out. Only state with legalized prostitution. I thought it was legal everywhere. That's what you tell the cops, bro. When you get popped with me to John. You say, oh, bro, I thought it ain't legal here. I wasn't paying for sexualations. I was paying for a tutor because I'm taking a history class about Denver.
Man.
There you go. Boom.
You ever hired a prostitute, Jim?
No, I don't pay for sex. I was banned.
I've never done it either. I couldn't imagine
And I'd be honest if I did.
Yeah, I'd probably tell people.
I don't know.
I just I mean, it just seems weird. You know, I don't know. I don't know where. It's almost like drugs. I don't even know where to go get drugs if I wanted to be
live in Colorado, Hoss. Them shits is everywhere. You gotta go outside and go cuckoo, 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 and they'll just fucking drop. Just go to Craigslist, bro. They're all over Craigslist. You know, because that was like the craziest thing for me was whenever I moved to, I lived in Washington State for a while and weed's legal there too. And it was like the first legalized state I'd ever lived in. You know, been to Florida and Texas and a few other states before that, but moved to Washington State.
Yeah.
And I remember opening up Craigslist and people were just selling pounds of weed on Craigslist, ounces of weed on Craigslist. Like, are you fucking kidding me? Is this a joke? It's like, nope. That's just how it is.
Yeah. When it looked legal here, because I really didn't pay attention to it because I don't really smoke. Mm-hmm. And
not really. He don't.
Yeah. I don't, yeah. But, you know, when I went and I was working for Joe, painting again for a little bit. So, of course, I was hanging out with all the pothead painters. And this guy, you know, Dale, he's like, that was his routine. And I'd always drive over to his house in the morning. And then we'd take the van wherever we went. And then on the way back to his house, you know, we'd have to drive by the liquor store to get him some, you know, like a 12 pack or whatever. And then, you know, once weed was legal, we had to go by the weed store afterwards too. Yeah, and I just thought, it's like, we're going to buy marijuana right now.
Damn right.
It was so fucking bizarre to just be like, okay, you know, we can go to Walmart or we can go buy some, some drugs.
Yeah,
everything's cool.
You want to know how you can tell Jeff doesn't smoke weed? Yeah, because he straight calls that shit marijuana.
Yeah, I know.
That's all good. But you know, that was the other thing when we were there. I was always like that when somebody came down, dude, take me to the weed store. I was like, okay, it's just right there, dude. It's just like a convenience.
It's no big deal. I know.
I mean, it's fixing to be like that probably a lot more places. It's starting to be too. It's like I said, Washington. Like when I first got to Washington State, you had to have a medical card. So you had to go to a you had to go to a BS doctor and just lie to them to get the card. And they would, they didn't even care. They're like, you have medical records? It's like, I was like, no. He's like, okay, it'll just be $50 extra. It's like, boom.
Yeah.
I'll take it.
Well, yeah, the medical marijuana thing was just such bullshit because that's like what happened here first too, and that's back when I was always painting full time and you know every painter I knew suddenly went in in the first week, and got a prescription for marijuana and I'd just be like, well, what are you going in for? Like, there's nothing wrong with you, And they'd all be like, well, I got back pain. I can't sleep. I can't, I mean, just any kind of bullshit thing they could think up.
Mom was like, you know? Digestive issues.
Digestive issues.
Yeah, they gave that shit to me for digestive issues, bro. And I didn't even freaking, fucking have stomach problems and blah, 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 blah. And they're like, shit, here you go. $50 extra. Boom. It's like, yes.
Yeah. But you know what? Go ahead.
Like a year and a half later, they got rid of medical and it went legal. So I was just like, well, I'm not going to get the card. I don't need that no more.
Yeah, that was the only thing that I noticed about it, like, that really changed, is like all the drug dealer painters, like the painters that would only be around like one day a week or whatever, they had to start working again. Like this one guy, Chris P, let's say his name is. out some dumbass.
Ass right now. Yeah.
But yeah, he had to come back to work like full time. He was such a pain in the ass too. I was like, oh god. So
yeah, he had to come back to work.
Yeah, because he didn't have his side business anymore. Everybody was just going to the weed store or whatever.
Yeah, well, dude, I mean that's when he didn't know how to go. He should just went legit. He should have bought a business license and got him a little building and off he went.
He should have. Yeah. So Nate says, I have anxiety broadcasting a video for the world to see. People scare me. It's cool, Nate. No,
it's all good, dude. It's all good. Don't worry about it. I don't even have nobody in the green room or nothing crazy, is there?
No, I'm sitting here looking at it. There's nobody here yet. So all
right, cool.
The link is in the chat in case anybody wants to be brave and go for it.
There you go. Do it. Right. What, man? No more Kill Reaver, Randy. No more going Kale Reaver.
Yeah, tennis elbow in their painting arms, probably. Yeah.
Shit. I'd be like, man, my big toe hurts. I need weed.
I remember it used to be so crazy. Like I remember this one younger kid, Brandon, just totally, like, when he realized I didn't smoke, you know, he was like, what? And he's like, you live in Colorado. It's like, why would you not, like, you know? I mean, it was like he came here to smoke, basically. Anyway, but yeah,
a lot of people.
Yeah,
they said, "Oh damn, I'm on that."
You know, it's like I don't really see like why, in a way, it was ever illegal, to tell you the truth, because there seems to be zero difference. Yeah. You know, like, do you notice any difference between it being legal and illegal?
Nah, the roads in Colorado didn't seem to change.
Yeah, that too.
That's my complaint. Because I guess Megan, you're the only one that know that. It's like when you pay for weed in Colorado, it has a hefty road tax that they basically tax you to fix the roads. And the roads are the shittiest roads I've ever driven on in Denver, Colorado. Somebody pockets that damn money.
We must have bad roads, because like so many people have told me that the roads
are bad. Suck, they suck.
Yeah.
First thing we said, like my wife said, we drove down some crappy road here in Texas. And I was like, man, this road sucks. And my wife's like, it ain't like a Colorado road. I was like, yeah, that's true. Fucking things are horrible.
What's so bad about them? I don't get it.
There's potholes and they just uneven really bad. And they like crack and stuff. Dude, that one major highway in Denver fucking like sunk while we were there.
Yeah, is that when that water main broke or whatever?
Yeah, that water main broke underneath and it sunk that road or whatever. It's like, dude. But I think the problem really with Colorado is it's got this thing where it's like the temperature fluctuates a lot there. It gets really cold and it heats up and really cold. I think that's bad on those roads.
I think that's probably got something to do with it, yeah. So Randy's at his mother-in-law's house. Yeah. And Nate takes a shot at his mother-in-law. Says, being at your mother-in-law's is depressing.
It could be. Better. He's eating really good, depending on what type of mother-in-law she is.
Yeah. How are you watching the R-Cast when you're at your mother-in-law's house?
On the phone. Yeah. Keep that thing turned down, dude. Yeah. I might get a wild hair up my ass and start saying crazy stuff.
He's probably got it on the big screen TV and they're all watching.
Yeah. Right. And Jeff's already mentioned the Ku Klux Klan on this show and we're talking drugs. Stop. This is, you never tried drugs. That's what
Jeremy Burks said. I've never tried drugs.
Yeah, stay that way, dude. Keep that mind clean and crisp. Yeah. Don't be doing much drugs, Jeremy.
I did try marijuana when I was a kid.
Whoa, I'm getting out of here.
I know. But that was it. It was like a one deal thing. I tried to smoke a cigarette once. But I just thought it was, I didn't see the point.
I've been that way. Yeah, I've been that way with cigarettes, dude. Definitely. Yeah. I was like I smoked a cigarette and I was kind of felt sick. And I was like, no, that ain't for me.
I'm not. It tasted gross. And then I thought, well, how would I even get a hold of these things? And like, I'm damn sure not getting a job to buy them. So that pretty much was like, not for me. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I mean, I drank, but it's like I'm not really a drinker. So I don't know.
I drink still a little here and there, but I don't know. I don't really drink more than a beer or two. I'm not like one of those guys that's like, oh, I'm going to keep drinking, you know? It's like the difference. Like, I'll drink a beer or two, like casually drink them, you know, and talk. And then I'm just going to throw my brother under the bus real quick. But my brother, he'll kill a suitcase of beer, dude, in one night, man. It's like, boom. I'm like, whoa, dude, calm down, man. And I'm talking, I'm talking the 24 packs, the big fucking ones. So drink those motherfuckers, dude.
Man,
he won't stop until all the beer is gone. And the minute he runs out of beer, it's like, I'm going to the store to get more beer. It's like, no, Lord. Dude, stay out of the car. And you think you got him calmed down and he's not going to get in the car. And then you're like, okay, next thing you know, you hear it squealing out of the driveway. You're like, son of
a Lord.
It's every time, dude. Me and my brother's done some. But this is how you have stories like, I hit a semi truck head on doing like 45 miles an hour. You know, I mean, he did that. He got bucked out of a boat one time into an oyster reef and had to get life flighted to Galveston. He hit a fucking car. He was racing a car drunk, and apparently a boat had, they had pulled this boat across the road and he didn't see it. And he hit that boat at almost 100 miles an hour.
Oh my God.
Got life flighted to Galveston that time. Yeah, dude, my brother's wild. I'm the calm one, guys.
Yeah. Ah! Jibrin's the positive sign.
Yeah, I am. I ended up now being the saint. And then I got my brother. And then I got my truck driving sister.
Yeah.
Seriously. No, seriously, though.
Driving the big rigs.
Yeah, dude. Wants to go by the name Tank.
We're finding out a lot about Jibrin right now.
I don't give a shit. I'm sober as hell right now. I'm not even nothing.
Put it out there.
Me, I don't care. What are they gonna do? Go look them up. Go look them up. Go find tell them I sent you. Tell them Large Marge sent you.
Oh, that's AKA cool.
Tank, my sister. I'm just kidding. You know, we have that beautiful family hate.
Really? Well, you and your brother like each other, right?
Yeah, me and my brother get along. Me and my sister don't. But it's all good. Yeah, my brother. The problem is I can't hang out with my brother because I end up with like assault charges and I get hemmed up by the cops and I end up in jail. And I'm totally blaming him for all that stuff, not me. But I mean, some of it's my fault, I'm sure, too. But yeah, he's just, man, we're like those guys. It's like, you know, that buddy in high school that you got around and he's just a bad influence on each other. Well, that's me and my brother.
Yeah,
and that's bad because we're the family, you know.
Yep.
But we're like that, dude. It's like, you know, get around him and next thing you know, it's like, what are we doing doing graffiti on these trains right now, dude? I'm like 40 something. What are we doing? I'm not looking to go to jail for this shit. He's that one guy that can talk me into that shit, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
come on, man, like the old days. And the next thing you know, my old ass is out there being stupid. And the next thing you know, there's a cop involved.
Yeah. Now there is certain people. I remember this one guy, one of my friends, Bob Draper. He was a little bit like that. He'd kind of show up every now and then when I was older. And that's like the shit we would do. We would go and like go get into trouble when you're way too old to be doing that kind of stuff, you know. You'd always be like, you know, have some fucking goofy idea. And I don't know why I would go along with it. So,
get around some of these old friends or my brother, though. My brother's the worst one
for me. Yeah.
I mean, we're bad on each other, dude. We're just bad influences to each other. So,
yeah.
Times. And here's, and let me just tell you, dude, my brother's that stereotypical guy. You got to know he's got like, I don't know, like, 5 AR-15s, you know, totally got assault with a deadly weapon charge. Yeah, dude. You know, good people, man. Good church going people. That's always tell my brother though. It's like he's always like, oh, I can't ever get with a good girl. Blah, blah, blah. It's like, well, why don't you quit pulling them out of the bars and go find one in a church, and she may stick around for a minute. May quit stealing your money.
Yeah.
You never know.
So. Yeah, but that is true.
I noticed Jeremy's the only one. Jeremy Burtz is the only one in the chat that says, "I've never tried drugs."
Yeah,
I'm throwing everybody another.
Never tried drugs, Randy.
I can. Yes. Have you not seen a picture of Randy Siplon, bro? And why would you say that while he's watching this show in front of his mother-in-law's house?
I know.
Of course he has. Yeah. Look at him.
He's eating. He looks like Chewbacca. He's in there eating turkey right now.
He better be. He better be eating good. Some potatoes au gratin or something. Something good. Something.
Yeah.
Some potato salad. Some deviled eggs.
Oh, that sounds good. I do like that. You don't like the double eggs?
Yeah. I mean, I'll eat anything besides. The only thing I won't eat is liver and onions. I don't like it. It's the only thing. I'll eat whatever else. I'll eat menudo. I'll eat lingua. I'll eat fucking deviled eggs. I don't give a shit. I'll eat chicken gizzards. I'll eat it.
I love chicken gizzards. I mean, that's like one of my favorite. What about what was that one? The middle one you said there, lingua.
Lingua. That's a tongue.
Oh, okay. I've never had that. Yeah. I don't know. I've never had that. I've never had like the Rocky Mountain oysters.
No, I ain't eating no balls.
Yeah, bro. I'm just. You know,
I'm not doing that shit. I figured that was just known. in my mouth. Not gonna happen. There you go. Thanks, mom-in-law. Randy's mom-in-law. I hope you're hearing the conversation now. He's not gonna put animal balls in his mouth. Well, you know, I'm not doing that Rocky Mountain oysters. What the fuck's wrong with y'all people, bro? Eating goat balls. Isn't that what they are, right? That's what that is, right?
Well, they're cows, I think. Oh,
that's right, cows. There you go. Probably cows. Yeah. Rocky Mountain oysters.
Hmm. Well, that's what they call them. I mean, if you get them in a restaurant, that's what they call them. So be wary.
I mean, I'll eat a frog leg. I'll eat some stuff, man. But
See, I've never had frog legs. I've always kind of wondered if, like, they're, like, I don't know. I mean, you know, it's just like frogs are so gross that, looks like we got somebody.
Someone's in
here.
Oh, it's Nate.
Nate. Hey, Nate.
How is it going? Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Welcome to the show, okay. Nate.
How's it going?
Good.
It makes me nervous because the live stream, the concept of so many people. I guess you probably don't think about it. You've probably done it so much. Yeah. So I have anxiety and stuff like that. So
that's cool.
It'll be fine. Yeah, I kind of quit watching what I say a long time ago. I just gave up caring on that one.
Yeah.
That was my big thing, watching what I said at the beginning, you know, and then now just whatever, dude.
Yeah, I think I remember that day when you were watching what you said, but I don't know.
Yeah, go watch all my old videos.
Might have
happened, right? Yeah. Well, here's what you got to think of, Nate. You got to realize you're only ruining Jeff's show. It's Jeff's people that are going to leave, not yours.
No, that's not true. Nobody that subscribed to me.
I'm watching the video. There's a lot of lag in between. Like the conversation and the video, and
oh yeah, you've got that. I've got two chats open right now. I've got like the chat.
Maybe my internet's real bad.
There is a bit from like the live or the chat that you see on YouTube to like the chat in here for some reason. It's I don't know what the deal is, but yeah, I've noticed that. So. But you're so one up in Frank right now, Nate. I don't know. I don't know how Frank's gonna feel about this when he gets there.
He's kind of competitive, isn't he?
Yeah,
a little bit. You know, in a good way. He's in a nice way.
Yeah.
So how's that comic book going, Nate?
Yeah, that comic is looking really good.
It's slow because this is kind of the first time I'm really, you know, digging into it. So I'm learning a lot. So There's some challenges. I was going to do like small scale because I figured if I work small, mm-hmm. I could get it done, you know, more time efficiently. I could do more, right? So it didn't work out because I couldn't get what I wanted. Mm-hmm. I couldn't communicate what I wanted to communicate visually. And so I had to redo one page anyway. So I've done
how
like,
big are you making?
I don't remember. I'd have to get it and look at it. I got measurements wrote down. It's in, I think it's like 285 millimeters. I work in millimeters because I can use math to downsize it and upscale it easier.
Okay, cool. So which ones, like, did you post any of the stuff that you were drawing smaller then? Because I remember you posting like a cover or something with that girl in the spacesuit. Was that when you were doing it smaller, or was that like the redraw there or something?
No, that's the small scale. Normal is like 11 by 17, right, for comic. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
My scanners, I just got a regular scanner. And I don't like breaking it up and putting it back together.
Yeah.
So I just, you know, that's another reason. So it's as big as you could get that scale and still be able to put it on the scanner. So it's like 285 mil. I think it's that 285 millimeters by... feel like it's definitely over 300. I think, I don't know, maybe I'm backwards, maybe the 285 is the length, I don't know, but either way, it's just barely, you know, it's as much as you could upscale it and still fit it on the scanner. That's what I did.
Yeah.
And it's a 8.5 by 11.5 scanner. Is that standard size?
Yeah, it's usually like,
yeah,
unless you get a wide format scanner.
Yeah, like my scanner, I think it is 11 by almost 7 or 17, 11 by 17 or something, a little bit bigger than that.
Don't you? So,
yeah.
Yeah.
So, I have a normal size, like you have, Nate. That is what I do, is I'll either do stuff at normal paper size, or if I'm doing something big, I'll have to double scan it and then go into Photoshop and cut and paste it into one sheet. So I do have to do that at times. Especially with paintings and stuff. I'm going to say something Jeff does, and I do it every once in a while. I'm kind of doing it with a few things right now. Jeff draws individual panels.
Yeah, I noticed that.
Pages in Photoshop.
I don't have anything, you know, high-tech software.
No Photoshop?
No. Not anything high-tech. No. Yeah.
What do you use to,
letter,
letter and format your stuff, so you're like scan.
Well, I'm printing out text and I'm I'm pasting it on there with some rubber cement.
Oh wow, that's wild. Well, that's how we used to do it back in the day.
Yeah, like it works, you know,
it does.
Are you printing?
I got a question. You work individual panels. How do you measure before you start working on them so that they lay out and it fits on scale? Or how do you get it to?
Like, I kind of like, I just kind of estimate. So like, this is like a top panel across a page that will have like, say, you know, three levels, so it'll have like about six panels or something, or five.
Yeah.
So like, this is the top panel. So like, as you can see, I don't draw the square around it. So like, once I scan this, I scan it bigger.
Crop it.
Exactly. Yeah. Then I crop it, and then I make the line in Photoshop around the panel, and You know what I mean? So it's like, I just kind of estimate. And then, you know, like when you put them all together, I definitely have troubles where like, you know, this is, doesn't fit there and that doesn't fit there. And it's like a jigsaw puzzle that you have to put together, you know, but yeah. It does kind of still work, but yeah, that's how I did like all of the Berserkernaut stuff. I have a really hard time like doing like multiple panels on a page anymore. I don't know why, but I kind of freeze up. So that's how come I like to do it that way. But.
What's the most amount of panels you'd work on a page?
I have a couple. Just like how many?
Yeah.
I mean, you could do, I don't know, like, how many, you know, like, I'd have to really think hard about that. But, I mean, like, I generally just kind of think of an average of like, six, you know, because that's sort of like the standard American comic type.
That way they're big enough. Yeah.
Yeah. But then a lot of mine go more like five or sometimes even four because I have, like, a big panel and then, you know, multiples of other stuff. I do have a comic.
Let me see. Yeah. How much art do you cut away though, Jeff?
I definitely cut away a lot.
A lot of art. Yeah. So like a lot of
the like that one's got three. That one just got two. And that one's four and then three. I just kind of play it by ear, you know. I like to go back and forth.
But you have these out though on thumbnails, like on your little pages though too.
Yeah, I do the thumbnail books. Like this was the one from Berserkernaut. Yeah, where I draw it all like roughly, so I know what I'm doing. See, and then that also kind of tells me, like, so like this panel, like when I would draw it, I would know to, you know, kind of slant it, you know, make it long, and then like when I scan it and put it in there, then hopefully it'll fit in there the way it's supposed to. So
that's cool. I think it works better having, you know, less panels for your style when you paint like that. That way you can, because if you paint real small, you're kind of shortchanging yourself, because, you know, you can get more and more detail and it works better if you,
No, I kind of agree. I think it does for my style. I'm not a guy who puts a lot of panels on the page anyway. So I'm always
like,
going.
The Watchmen's got like nine panels, doesn't it?
I know. Yeah, the Watchmen's very it's very standard. And
it works,
I don't know if it,
but yeah.
It's that standard. Actually, I think you're right. I think, isn't it like 3, 3, and 3? That and they like that
whole so.
Lined up like that. Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah. Like Kirby and them, they used to do like a lot of the six, you know, like 2, 2, and 2. And, you know, I think that works. But, you know, like once you got into like the 90s and like the Image guys, then they were like just breaking that all apart.
Yeah, they changed it up a lot. But
yeah,
I like old school. I think, in my opinion anyway, I like old school's the best school.
Yeah.
But that's just my taste. Everybody's got different taste buds, so.
Well, I love, you know, like the way they paneled like back in the day, like with the Spirit and like that, those kind of comics, like Will Eisner, like the newspaper, you know, they were originally done for the newspaper, but then eventually were reprinted. And a lot of those have like, you know, they'll be like 8, 9, 10 panels.
Yeah, a lot of panels.
And, but yeah, since it was bigger, I think the art looked just better, you know, because they were drawing so much bigger. But like nowadays, like with comics being so smaller, I almost feel like less panels is a little better. I don't know. I think you can make it work a lot of different ways.
And it depends on your storytelling type, like how you're, because I write my story first. And then after I got that, I kind of try to plan it out. And sometimes when you're editing, you know, a little because I do the thumbnails, right? And that's how I start laying it out like that, see composition and then, you know, placement. And
so do you write out like a full script, or you just kind of plot and then go to thumbnails, or is it like
I write out some directions I write out all the scripts, some directions, because I'm doing it, so I don't have to write out like if I was telling somebody else. And sometimes you have to, like, if you get an idea that you think's really good, or you know, something that's elaborate, or something that's like a foreshadowing event, or something that you're gonna build on throughout the story, right? I'll have to write that down so I get it and solidify it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of how I do it too. Like, I'll write a plot and then I'll put some dialogue and stuff. I just kind of write fast. But then I've always got to get my book out. Like, I was showing Gibran this because we were talking about a story that we're doing together. And like, these are sort of my scribbles for like this kind of stuff. And they're like, you know, you can't see, but it's like, I can't write
you the know whole what thing without. Yeah,
exactly.
You got it in your head.
I have to start working out the panels, and then I can finish the writing, because then I kind of know how much dialogue goes. You know what I mean? And
yeah.
So it's sort of like the thumbnailing, and then also the rest of the writing all kind of happens at the same time. But I can't just write without that. I have to have, like, you know, that
visual,
sort of
visual to go with it.
So exactly.
They play on each other to inform what the other does. You start with the writing, but then you kind of do the visual, and then
then it kind of comes together. Yeah, and then when I do like the one I showed you guys, the little book, that's almost like when I tighten it down, and I kind of know, and then I kind of just tighten it down so I can still tell, like, you know, because a lot of times I'll be doing these, and then I'll go back and I'll be looking at them, and I can't figure out what the hell I drew. You know, if I can't really remember what it is, you know, I'll be like, wait, I don't remember.
But when it's fresh, you got that.
Yeah, yeah, like when you're just trying to figure it out, you kind of remember. But
here's a question: how tight do you dialogue all that stuff beforehand, Jeff? Like,
well, when I get to this point, I like to write the dialogue. But then I notice, like, when I actually scan and put the dialogue in the pages, that really is the final pass on the dialogue, because then I actually kind of rewrite stuff a little bit there too. But I try to get it done at this point so that I don't have a lot of bad stuff, you know.
That stuff that you had, we were talking about last night, that stuff was pretty tight.
And I'm writing that a little bit more tight too, because it's like me and you, and so I want to tell you like what I'm doing. So there's parts of it I'm kind of like, no, just kind of finish it out so that he knows what I'm talking about. So
gotcha.
Are you splitting out the art too?
Mm-mm. He just gonna do the art on that.
I mean, yeah, all the art. Okay.
He's gonna do the art on that. It's like, basically, right now we're trying to do, like, we're going to have an anthology style book. This is one of the stories in it. This is, like, I guess one of the bigger stories in the book. And I don't know, but me and him are both so stuck on this story right now that it's in a good way, though, you know.
How many pages you got planned out so far?
Well, I don't quite have it completely tightened down into that, like, form I was showing you where it's all sketched out. So, like, right now I'm at, like, 6 pages in to like a certain part of the story that we were talking about. I know that sounds confusing, but it's like, I'm figuring that it's going to come in around 16 pages, like just this story. Yeah. And then, but like, Gibran's got his stories that he's working on, and exactly. So we're thinking like a 48 page, like, magazine format thing. That's for cool. The whole. Yeah, exactly. So there'll be like stories that are around 8 or 16 pages. Mm-hmm. In it,
yeah.
Put some cool little ads and stuff in there, kind of.
We want to have some ad room and stuff, and then like some pinup room, and
and just trying to do some of the stuff. We get a lot of cool ideas, and some of the show inspires a lot of cool ideas for us, and we talk about them after the show, and just like, we should need to start doing some stuff with some of the stuff. So, kind of just trying to push some of that stuff out, and really, this, I don't know, man, I'm just. Right now, I'm just so stuck in this cowboy story.
Yeah, it looks cool. It looks good so far, what I can tell.
Yeah,
I mean, I like Western, so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, me too.
I don't know. I don't want to give too much away, but we've been really, like, getting these like Western tropes going in the storyline that are just like, ah, oh! Like last night, man, we like said one at the same time, basically. Yeah. Oh my God, we gotta do that.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, I don't know. Fun. You know, thinking about it, it's like the way this is coming off, what this little story, it reminds me, and I'm probably wrong, it's like if Clint Eastwood directed Blazing Saddles almost. You know, it's like it's great. Yeah. All of a sudden now that field gets really funny, you know. So
yeah. Yeah, I'll tell you what you could do. You could have a commercial in the middle of it where guys advertising cigarettes, and the end of the commercial, the guys did. So there you go.
Yeah. How long is your story that you're working on there, Nate?
I was planning to say, I don't know if it's going to be, you know, just because I think it's a good idea don't mean anybody else's, right? So I can be biased. It's like your own crap don't stink to yourself, you know?
Yeah.
So I figured I'd make it short, do a short page, you know, probably, I don't know, 10 pages, something short.
Yeah.
And get it finished and kind of at the end of it insinuate where I was going with the story so that people can see, one, the style, the two, you know, the story, just a little, what do they call that? When you're advertising something to get your attention. What's that called? Huh?
Like a preview?
Kind of, but that wasn't the word I was thinking of.
You mean like almost like a trailer of like a movie or something? Or
yeah, the same principle as a trailer, but you know, just something to test it, because that way at least it's getting finished. Uh-huh. The whole thing that I got planned out isn't finished, but I have something that is finished, and that's like also the goal for myself is to have something. A book that I can hold in my hand that is, you know, it's not a big book, but it is a book, you know?
Yeah. So. No, I think that's a great way to do it. And that's kind of like, you know, the way we're doing this one, where it's kind of like a shorter story that has like all these threads that you can follow and make it into a bigger story, you know, because we're planning on making it bigger, but we want, you know, the whole first part to kind of wrap up. Yeah. I think just in case, because like we both come off such long projects where like, just in case we kind of don't want to go on with it, we don't have to like, you know, and you still have a finished thing. So I think that's a great way to do it, you know? So you got like something to shoot for that's not like, you know, 5 years off in the future or something. It's only like, you know.
Yeah, you don't stick all this time into this one project and then 2 years down the road going, man. Am I going to keep going? I feel like I'm stuck in this project now a little bit, you know,
mm-hmm.
You want to move a different direction. So,
yeah, I didn't want to be in that because when you're so invested in it and you don't know how everybody else is going to respond. Cause if everybody else is kind of like, I don't care, you know, you can't make people care. You can only just do what you can do, you know, and see how they respond. That's all I know.
For sure. You got to throw it at the wall and see if it sticks, man. Not everything's going to stick for sure.
Yep.
But like, what's your plan here? So it sounds like you're talking about making a printed copy.
EJB says proof of concept. I don't know if that's what you meant.
not exactly. That wasn't the word I was thinking of.
So
it would be.
You're going to do this 10 pager and then what you're going to do with it? That's the ultimate thing afterwards. What's the big plan here? You're gonna put it like on a store envy store? What's your idea here?
I thought that far ahead. I was planning on selling some at the college. I was thinking small town, you know, and advertising on the Artcasters and, you know, everywhere else I could find like online that deals in comics. I was actually thinking about, I know it's, it might sound stupid, but you know the comics Kayfabe? You know that mm-hmm. YouTube channel?
For sure.
I was thinking about mailing them a copy of my book. Just, you know, just giving it to them. Mm-hmm. And what's the worst that could happen? They don't ever acknowledge it exists. So if they show it and if they like it, you know, maybe that's like advertising. I don't know.
Oh yeah, amen. Definitely. It's a way to get out there into that other little market of people for sure.
Yeah.
I definitely watch their shows. I definitely, you know, they've done a few that you know, they've done a couple of busy ones that I've watched. They did they had somebody on a while back and I was just like, oh my God.
What are they? Like, are they comic book artists?
They are artists and they review comics and sometimes they interview, shoot interviews, what they call it, to like other comic book artists and writers.
Okay.
He's been on the show. I want to say Eastman was on their show a while back or something crazy.
I didn't see that one.
Maybe yeah. I'm wrong. There's somebody. I'm gonna go look him up right now because I want to know now.
I think I'm. Yeah, I think that sounds good. And then you know, like if you print some up, I mean that's the great thing about print on demand now, man. You can print like one copy or 10 copies, and you know it's not like back in the old days when you have to print like 2,000 copies or something.
Yeah,
but yeah,
you couldn't afford that. You'd get in the hole fast and. You're committed.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, and then like, you know, if you got some and then we'd help you sell some if you were into that. Cause we're always hanging around the old, chat and stuff. So definitely.
Yeah, I'll take all the help I can get.
You chat like Randy.
Do what?
Reaver, which is still in demand on Indiegogo, guys. So if you missed out on Kill
Reaver, he made his. He's got over 1,500. You know, isn't that what he's got?
I think so. Now, yeah,
yeah,
yeah. That's pretty good. That's his first one, isn't it?
Yeah,
yeah.
That is pretty good, isn't it? I mean, you know, when you really like
over 500, I'd be good. Yeah.
As long as you can get the book printed out of it, you know, that's the thing. Get the book printed and shipped. That's where I think some people get a little messed up though. Sometimes they got they're giving too much away for what they're the money that's coming in, and then they kind of screw the pooch and they can't.
And then there's the shipping. If you're shipping it out, that's going to be a problem. I'm going to have to figure it out.
Got to be careful.
I'm going to share this in the chat.
Boom. What's that?
Cartoonist Kayfabe had Kevin Eastman on 6 months ago.
Oh, Kevin Eastman. Okay, cool.
That one in the chat.
I closed out of the main one because it was just lagging so far behind, right? But where it's recording. So how can I see the chat and this?
You should be in a window right now that says private, and there's a box right that says private chat and comments. Just click
comments on the comments. Is where it's at. Okay, there you go.
You should be able to see it. It's a little bit behind the other one, but it catches. You know, it'll catch up. Cool. Now that he's in the hot seat, I have one question for Nate. Are you?
Am I? IndieGate. IndieGate. Yes. IndieGate. Probably not. But yeah. Sure. I support independent comics because I think that that's where it should be, you know, anyway, because that's, you know, if you make your book, you should own your book. If you make a character, you should own your character. Whatever you do, you should get credit for it.
Yeah.
And you should get paid for it. Yeah. So. And indie is the way I think of the future, to be honest.
No, I agree with that. I mean, it's probably the way things should have been like all along, really.
Yeah. And, but you got to rely on a bunch of rich white dudes to, you know, their money.
Yeah.
Basically. And also the people with the money are usually the people that are good at being full of shit. And they're talking, you know, they're pimping it out. You know, people like Stan Lee, he was a salesman. If he wasn't he wasn't in comic books, he'd been a used car salesman. So
no, that's very just
pissed
true.
Everybody off, Nate.
It's true. I mean, dude, just look at his interviews. Look how he talks, man. That's what he does. He talks. He talks the hype game. And not all artists have that ability, you know.
Yeah.
He's
a cheerleader for comics for sure.
Yeah, for Marvel Comics, he sure was.
And he was a mouthpiece too, absolutely.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Have y'all seen that video that came out? I think that Lucifer Storm had posted it on Facebook. That guy, what's his name? Russ Leach's boy. It's an interview, I guess, with Stan Lee, and he's like dropping the F-bomb in it. It was strange because one of the best phrases out there is like "fuck you" or something like that. And I was just like, "Whoa,
really?"
See if I can find it. But yeah, I saw that and I was just like, "Wow,
that's pretty wild." I wonder what like the context of that.
I don't think I ever heard him cuss.
Yeah,
right now,
it's pretty funny.
See here, Stan Lee, Stan, fuck you, probably.
Stan, fuck you. Man. Yeah, so that's... Are they still doing that show? I thought they posted on there like this was going to be the last one or something.
What, who, huh?
Russ Leach and that other guy.
Oh, no, just for the holiday season, I think.
Oh, it's like the last one of like 2020 or something, I guess. I get it. I fell for it.
Yeah, they got you. They were basically doing their last show for the year, I think.
So are you, yeah. So you're like in college, right, Nate? Then.
Well, I just got registered. I was in college. I had to take a break. Now I'm going back in January. So
okay.
It's hard to find a place out there. Nope, I'm going
to where?
Right now?
No, I mean where's college? Don't tell me where you're at now. Don't dox yourself.
Well, if I tell you my college, then everybody's gonna know where I'm at. I'm too paranoid.
No, that's fine. You don't have to do that.
Yeah, if you don't want to do that, don't do that.
I was just curious, like what you're going to college for. Is it like some comics related type thing or it's art education? Oh, okay.
Yeah. They don't offer anything for comics. I would probably take it though if they did.
Right. So. Yeah.
But it's BFA in art education, I believe it is, Bachelor of Fine Arts Art Education. I think is what it is. So, I've got some of it, but the thing I'm worried about the most is the praxis, and that's the education. If you don't have the praxis, you can't take the classes that will allow you to be a teacher. And I haven't took math in so long.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know it anymore. I forgot it. Mm-hmm. You don't use it, you lose it, and it's gone. So I have to learn some algebra and all that crap again.
Yeah. It'll probably come back easier this time, you know, once you've already known it.
I could hope.
Yeah.
That's not my natural affinity of you know, learning, my brain type. So
yeah. You shouldn't even have to learn like algebra and that stuff, in my opinion, considering like an artist, you know. Like what's an artist need to know? With math,
that's what a calculator's for.
There you go. But that's
as long as you got it. Go ahead.
Well, I was just gonna say when my wife went to school, she had to do the same thing. She has a degree in like commercial art, and she had to take math and English and all that crap. And I was like, "What do you got to do this for? What's this got to do with drawing?"
So she's an artist too. What did you said she did financial stuff, didn't you?
She's an accountant, yeah. But originally, yeah. I mean, we're older now, so this was a long time ago. When I first met her, she was in art school.
And okay.
Yeah, she went for commercial art, and then she stayed in school and got, like, a degree in, like, computer animation. Like, this was way back when. And wow. And then, cool. You know, got a job at, like, at Hallmark forever, and then she eventually said she was tired of having these crappy jobs, and she went back for to be an accountant, and now she has a good job. So, yeah.
Well, as long as she can, you know, do it, and she's not too stressed out every day. Yeah, that's a good thing.
Yeah. Oh well, yeah. She seems to like it. I don't know. I don't think I'd want to do it, but you know. So Randy says you have to have a certain amount of general ed credits for a degree. I guess he's just explaining it to somebody in there.
Yep. Yeah. I got the ADCI 201 class. Every college is different, but that's the first one. And it was fun, you know. They was doing this thing, and everybody else is doing different degrees, and I come in here and I'm doing art, right? And so they said, you pick a thing, you get three people in your group, me and two other people, and you teach them something. And I said, you know what'd be cool is if you learn how to sew up a wound, suture.
Oh, God. Okay.
So what I do is I got some styrofoam blocks and then some of this thin. It's a softer type of foam. And I mixed together some gelatin and I made like a prosthetic type and coated it over top of that, the soft foam, so it would resemble like tissue. And I put like an incision in it and it looked kind of like skin because I tinted the gelatin. And, I took regular sewing needles and I bent them so that it was curved because, you know, sutures are curved. So it was cheaper that way, right? And I got some fishing line because it's suture material is sort of like the fishing line. And I made a prosthetic appliance to apply on this girl's leg. It was in my group. Mm-hmm. I made like a blood device that she would put it to her leg. She'd go to the bathroom, tape it to her leg. I told her how to do it, and she would reach in her pocket and she could squirt the bottle, and it would squirt blood out the wound, the prosthetic. And I did the makeup on the outside of her leg. I was going to do it, and I had it all planned out. And come down to the day before, and she said, "Nope, can't do it. I'm chickening out. I can't do it." I'm like, really? I've already went through all this work. I was doing almost all the work, and that it pissed me off. So I told her, I said, no, because she tried to blame me. No, wait, dude, that ain't, no. So that made me mad.
Yeah, that's terrible. What was she saying that blamed you for, like, what did you do? So, like, you did everything.
She said she could, it's one of those things where you say something and you don't really mean it, right? So, okay, the night before I said, okay, in order to have enough time, we have to be here at least to set it up, to apply everything 30 minutes early, at least. She texted me 15 minutes before. Not 30 minutes before, not 40 minutes before, 15 minutes, which would not have given me enough time. And she said, well, you know, I'm ready. And no, 30 minutes. This is too late. And then she tried to blame me because, you know, so I said, no, that's not how it works. So I look like a bad guy, but I can be the bad guy. I don't care.
That sucks. So what was it? Was it for a class? Did you guys just get a bad grade, or what was it for?
No, we did good. We just didn't. I didn't do what I wanted to do. I wanted to be like. You ever seen the movie Summer School?
I don't think so.
Yeah, let's see. I'm trying to think who's in it.
I've seen that movie. I think I have.
The guy from NCIS. The first Grisham? NCIS. Huh?
The guy Grisham? That guy?
He's got white hair. Short white hair.
Yeah, like the guy who plays like Gus Grisham or whatever
on NCIS. Is that his name? I don't watch it. Mom and Dad watch it, but it's kind of...
Probably. Yeah. Probably.
Like his name is Mark. One. Mark something.
Mark Harmon?
I think that's it.
Oh,
I'm
yeah.
I'm looking at the poster, so...
That's... Yeah,
okay.
One with him. Yeah, there's like different NCSI, so there's like... I think he's like the one that's in... Or I don't remember.
Yeah. But there's anyway, these kids are in summer school and like I saw it as a kid and I was like, this is really cool because they had this the scene where they had it all like it wasn't Halloween, but they did like prosthetic guts and eyeballs and like they was all mutilated, right? And they was trying to mess with him to get him to I don't remember. It's been so long. I think they was trying to get him to come back to teach them because they was at that point they was ready to learn. And just seeing the prosthetics and stuff like that. So that was kind of where I was thinking that. And I thought, well, it's possible that the fake blood because you got to put red food coloring. It's possible that would stain the floor. So maybe it was a good idea that I didn't do it because it probably would get on the floor. Yeah, I don't know. I was trying to find a positive, something to say, okay, well, whatever.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, I guess you could have put some plastic down or something, but yeah.
Yeah, well, I was going to try to fool everybody in the room to make it seem as if she'd actually got cut. And it's usually,
I see.
You know. Yeah, I was wanting to make it look real.
Yeah,
to set it up,
stitch it up
so everybody's adrenaline is going to be pumping. Yeah, I was wanting to, you know, to scare everybody, and then that way, that was my goal anyway. It might not have worked, but I think it would have been. It looked pretty good. I think it did. So,
yeah. That's cool. I like it. I think it's a cool idea. It's too bad it didn't work out.
No, but we did get to teach with the blocks that I made. So I got some like forceps type things. You go to Walmart and get the like for fishing to get the hooks out of the fish mouth.
Yeah.
I use those and that makes it easier to tie the knot. So
oh yeah, yeah. The tie up the knot. I remember like, yeah, because I've had some stitches or whatever and they had like those things that they were kind of grabbing the needle with and poking it through, you know, that kind of stuff. I remember all that. Yeah.
I've gotten a lot of stitches.
Have you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
After that I cut my thumb pretty bad. It's like a camel toe thumb. And I got a chance to try it out. It's difficult to sew yourself
up. Oh, man. Jeez.
Even on just your finger.
Yeah. Well, didn't it hurt?
No.
It didn't hurt after you had whiskey.
When you cut yourself real deep, it deadens the nerves. So it helps. Like when you do it right then.
Yeah.
It helps because and what I do is as soon as I get cut, I go get alcohol. Mm-hmm. And I first take water, I run it out just in case there's some kind of dirt or something in it. And then I take alcohol and I saturate it and I take a Q-tip with the alcohol and I scrub it.
I figured you were going to say, the wound. I got a big pull off of whiskey there. Kind of helps. No, I'm kidding.
No, drinking the whiskey. Yeah. I don't drink. I used to drink a little, but not a whole lot. Not enough to say I did. Yeah.
No, I guess that
I drank enough to say I didn't. You see what I did there?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, but you dump it all over the cut, and then that kind of like sterilizes.
That cleans it, yeah. And you know, but then it doesn't. If you do it immediately, the nerves are dead. You know, it doesn't hurt as bad. But when you wait the next day, you know that's yeah.
Yeah. Well, one time I cut my wrist real bad, and I was like at Thanksgiving actually, and so I didn't go to the hospital because I just thought, oh, you know, it's like I'll go on, you know, when I get back home. And then I went like the next day to the hospital, and the guy cleaned out the cut, and he said, well, we can't stitch it up like the next day. You have to wait like a couple days to make sure it doesn't get infected and then stitch it up. He said, like, either do it right away or you got to wait a bit.
Okay.
You know, in between. Yeah. That's what he was saying. And, you know, so I didn't know that.
Makes sense.
Yeah. So they didn't stitch it up that day. And then I went home, and then I was just like, oh, I'll just try to let it heal up. But I don't know. Dominic Graves says, I did one with whiskey and fishing line.
he sewed himself up.
I guess so. Oh. You guys got something in common there.
Yeah.
I've never.
I just play the game where you'll do the old construction site trick where you like wrap
super
like
glue.
Toilet paper or paper towels and duct tape that shit down.
Oh yeah, yeah. That works on some, but sometimes it's too deep. You gotta do something.
Yeah.
I don't like super glue because I feel like when you do super glue, it heals from the outside in, mm-hmm. and the nerves mm-hmm. don't. The nerves take longer to reconnect when you're healing from the outside in my opinion, from my experience.
Yeah.
What a pick at that dry glue.
Would be no problem. Yeah.
That dry glue. Because I'm bad about that. I'll like pick scabs off and stuff.
Ran into a nail sideways on my forehead. That's what Dominic Gray said.
Yeah. That don't sound like stitches. That sounds like a tetanus shot.
Yeah, that's
probably like another that. Good reason to go to the hospital.
Yeah, so, yeah that's like a 16 penny nail or number eight, go. Or just what get kind of nail is it?
There you go, a little finishing nail. Okay, you're okay.
I cut my hand on a nail once, and that's what it was. It was like one of those finish nails that was sticking up, and the you know they just have that small tip. And I just scraped myself along it.
Yeah.
So yeah, they can definitely get you if you hit it wrong.
Oh yeah.
So, playing tag.
Yeah.
Like oh man. I got thrown in. I'm playing tag. It's like me. It's like I get these things. Oh, I got hurt doing that. Oh, really? What'd you do? Well, you know, I fell off a bike or something. I'm like,
yeah.
Hey, I thought it was going to be all cool and tough.
Yeah. I'm not tough. I'm just poor.
I'm the same way. Remember the one time they said I need stitches? I didn't go get them, but it's like I was running. And somebody opened up a door and hit me in the face with it.
Oh, man. That was a good one.
Yeah, I just busted my freaking, like, brow open really bad. And I mean, we just put Band-Aids on it and went on my merry way and then got home. And my grandmother was like, oh, my God.
Yeah.
I didn't think it was that bad, you know?
It was blood. Yeah, as long as it's not bleeding all over the place.
Oh, no, it was, apparently. That was the problem.
Oh, it's still bleeding? Oh, yeah. Band-Aids wasn't.
It was just like, apparently I just didn't realize that blood was just running down the side of my face. Come home, like, what's up? Like, she's just like, oh, my God. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not big on it. I got to, like, drop a brick on my foot or something if I'm going to go to the fucking doctor.
Yeah. Especially when you're a kid, like that was like you know, I always had like real fear of stitches, especially after getting them once. And I was like, nah, you never wanted to go back and get stitches again.
So, it's not the fear of the stitches, bro, it's the fear of that bill that's gonna show up.
Yeah, but I mean, when you're a kid, though, you know,
when you're a kid for sure,
because then you got to get a shot, you know, they got to numb it, which is like you know, scary and everything.
Or when they do that thing where they're like, they'll stick the needle inside like the wound and like start spraying. They'll start spraying cocaine inside the wound that they gotta mess with. Yeah, there's stuff like that's fun.
Yeah, I guess every kid's gotta go through it.
I couldn't do that. Yeah, I don't, maybe I could. Maybe I probably could have an easier time doing that to somebody else, maybe than me. You know, I don't know. Something about when it's me, it's like, like when I dropped that brick on my foot, dude, it was like, I'm fine, I'm fine. My wife took that sock off, and the top of my foot looked like it had a ruby red grapefruit on top of it. It was so swollen. She's like, I wasn't even looking. I was like, I'm fine. She goes, look at your foot.
Not fine. Yeah, like, it's swollen.
Yeah. It's because it busted all those blood vessels in the top of my foot, and it instantly
swelled
up because of it. Yeah.
As long as you don't get blood poisoning, you know, you're good.
No clots or nothing. No,
and clots, yeah, that too. Yeah. I want that
shit a lot and going up your leg into your heart or your brain. That's bad.
Was your foot broke? Would you
I fractured. No, nothing. No, I wasn't broken.
Yeah, oh, okay.
Really, really
dude, I mean, the same foot. That was that weak-ass cinder block, bro. I dropped a stinking – I mean, me and another guy were carrying a Coke machine. We were carrying it. And I started slipping out of my hand, dude. I was like, put it down, dude. I'm going to drop it. And he just stood there and looked at me, and it slipped right out of my hand while I was trying to get it down. I dropped that on the same foot and did not break it.
Oh, man.
It did not break it. That time
you're talking I was like, about like the blocks like you used to build like foundation with
like cinder blocks. Well, this last time I dropped a cinder block. The time before that I dropped a Coke machine, like literally like you know a big ass Coke machine, like one you should move with a dolly. But we were stupid. We thought we'll lean it over and we'll just carry it over there. And I let go of it. And I mean, dude, let me put it this way: I was on a wooden like pier and beam house when this happened. It fell on my foot. They got it off my foot. I was like, fuck, fuck. And then ended up going to the doctor, came, it was my house, this happened. I came home, and I dented the floor.
Yeah.
Put a dent on the floor, but didn't break my foot. So, thank God.
You got any steel-toe shoes?
I got some flat-ass feet is what I have.
Yeah, but sound like you need to get some steel toes. That way you can, you know, make sure that, yeah.
Yeah, that's how you cut your toes off, though. You ain't ever heard of those stories? Motherfuckers, like, drop those lift gates.
Yeah, that's what they're designed for when there's so much weight. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, man.
But if you're just dropping, like, a couple hundred pounds, they won't cut your toes off. They'll protect them.
Yeah. I don't know how much a Coke machine weighs.
I want to hear the story of why you were hijacking this Coke machine.
I had Coke machine, yeah. Yeah, I thought about
that. Wow. It's a 1969 7-Up machine that I paid $100 for.
Oh, okay. Oh, wow. Yeah. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
My friend sold me this Coke machine. He said, shop the 7-Eleven. I'll save this Coke machine for $100. Oh, my brother. Okay, let's go.
You know the best if I start in with, well, my brother.
Yeah. So Tim says, I love the start on the drawing. What is it going to be? Gibran, that looks great. Are you selling that?
I've got a little Christmas story I'm supposed to be doing. That's what's up.
I can hear you doing it for Frank's Taraku thing.
I need to do something. Yes, and maybe, because I need to do something for that. I keep saying I'm going to do something for that, and I'm just don't make me use my brain too much today. I mean, I don't ask going to use it much ever, but today less.
I understand with the headache, dude. That's it. Migraines are bad. They're not no joke. They're serious deal.
Yeah, man. And I get like I said, both of them, man. Like both of the bad ones, like the sinus ones, I get real bad. Like that's what I had today. And then I get those ones. I don't know if anybody else ever gets those. Where it's like it'll start impairing your vision. It'll like in your vision that fucks with you. Oh, dude, I can't. Those will start giving me anxiety attacks because I feel like I'm going blind.
Yeah, that's not good.
How long do like those last? Because I'll get those, but then there won't be like any pain involved. It'll just be like these like sparkly things that kind of get worse and worse, and then they go away in about a half hour. But
really, no, I'll have them a little longer than that.
Yeah. I don't know though. Like I didn't even know what they were. Some girl told me that was a migraine, but I was like, well, there's no headache. It's just this weird thing that happens every now and then. So
I usually get those right before the migraine. So
CB some veins on Santa, write him out.
It is that. I don't know if I pulled that out last. I'm gonna pull this out this time. Look. since we were talking,
you got a pretty big bicep there. You got,
yeah, one.
Yeah.
Good shoulder too. Here we go. But I'm gonna pull out this the old dread book because me and Jeff were looking at this the other day. I forgot that there's a Christmas story in it. I'm gonna we'll look at it. There we go. See, got this. I wonder who that guy is. I wonder what's going on right here.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Track. They got something on the blip. They got a blip on the scanner there. So they launched some shark missiles at it, flying, zooming at him, and then of course Santa's got to say shit.
That's pretty good.
Why is this reindeer's head blowing off like that? What did they do?
Killed Santa. Oh man! Yeah.
And then you got it right here. Dread to control aircraft coming down. So dread's off. And he comes up, he rides up, and he says, look like this pilot survives. There's a trail of blood. And he follows the trail of blood to find Santa Claus with his prompt. Got to get his plumber's crack going a little bit there. You see? Santa's going to deliver those presents no matter what. Look at, why does he look like that, dude? What is going on? Why is Santa? He got busted up. You know, ain't going to put up with it.
So is Santa Claus dead or just the reindeer?
He's dead. The reindeer's dead. Santa's alive. He's barely making it. He's trying to deliver these presents anyway. Until Dread rides up and blasts him with the motorcycle here, and then you end up with there's Santa now. Looking, he ain't looking so good.
But
you can't bring Santa down. He's up again trying to deliver these presents. And then apparently he dies on the doorstep of some kid's house.
Oh, how terrible.
Man. Yeah.
There's a Simon Bisley Christmas story for everybody. And that's funny. This is a second story he did. I think before this one, he had did the Lobo Paramilitary Christmas.
Yeah, that's what Randy was just asking. Lobo Christmas special?
Yeah. You sure?
I don't have probably the one he's talking about.
No, that was another one. Yeah,
I don't have that one. I wish I did. I don't have the military. I need to get it. It's like I'm missing that and like two Lobos backs, and I'll have all of those.
Is that the one where he fights Santa or something?
That one, the Easter Bunny hires Lobo to put a hit out on Santa.
Oh, that's
right. Down there, and he basically kills all the elves, and then Santa's like yoked up, badass, and he's got like this knife, and he has this knife fight out with Santa and kills him at the end.
Yeah, that's what I remember.
And then they even, like, somebody made, like, a little independent movie of that at one point. I think I've showed it
to you. Yeah, like, you sent me that.
Yeah, so y'all can hunt that. Or you should hunt that down.
I wonder if it's against the law to kill a fictional character. Somebody that's not, like, like the Easter Bunny and Santa Claus. Oh, wait. Yeah. They might be kids watching. I shouldn't say that.
There better not be kids watching. Yeah.
Well, it's gonna. Yeah, I just ruined everybody. I feel bad now.
Yeah,
yep. Dead people. Enjoy.
We had that one like 14-year-old kid coming. I wonder if he believes in Santa for a while.
He didn't believe in much.
Yeah.
Let's see here. Where is that at? Lobo. I'm gonna pull up that Lobo Paramilitary Christmas and throw it in here.
Well, Dominic threw out a question. You ever have trouble setting up a platform to sell your guys' work? Or do you have someone else do that and find motivation problems? I just want to draw. I'll do that. I find motivation problems. Yeah. I wonder what it means by platform. Just like a place to sell your work?
Or advertising, I think, is what it sounds like.
Yeah. I mean, like you put it up and then you're trying to get people to come buy it. I mean,
yeah.
I've had a lot of luck with like eBay. I mean, that's like kind of
how do you get people to how do you like steer people to your eBay though, other than your YouTube? Because you got like 40 now, don't you? 40,000.
Yeah. So. Well, that's kind of how making videos of my art, doing shows like this, putting my art on Facebook. You know?
I was reading Randy's stop. Hey, Frank might be watching.
There you go. Yeah, don't.
About Santa Claus.
Santa Claus.
Yeah.
Santa Claus.
Etsy, e-commerce. I mean, I've never had much luck on Etsy, though. That's where I have a bunch of friends, for sure.
eBay, dude. eBay's like, believe it or not. I mean, I even sell stuff on eBay.
I think, yeah. It just depends what you're selling. And I think Etsy's more of a, even though they are a little bit like eBay, where there's like a bigger platform. Like, I think that people still, you know, they search eBay for like comic book art or sketch cards or, you know, like those kind of big broad terms. And so, you know, if you have your stuff and then you have in the title like comic book art or like sketch card or something like that, then there's a chance people will run across your stuff, you know. And then, you know, from there, like once you get people buying, then I find like, you know, a lot of those people come back for commissions. And I feel like that's like where the real gravy is. Mm-hmm. When people come back to get, you know, original stuff from you.
Yeah. The hardest thing is getting that thing shipped out. So, believe it or not, it's like selling it is one thing. Getting it shipped. Boy, that's a whole different ballgame.
I love shipping, man. I eat shipping for breakfast.
You know what? I gotta say though, they opened a post office 2 blocks away, so shipping may be changing. It may be a lot easier, you know.
Yeah,
down there and ship now. So.
I mean, I agree. Yeah, shipping is tough, but it's like, you know, if that's what you're gonna do or that's how you're gonna do it, then you just gotta get good at it, you know. Because especially in the beginning, I had trouble with it, but now it's like I don't even think about it anymore. Was it slow starting out finding
your customer?
Customers. Well, I started, like, this is how I started, is I started selling sketch cards when sketch cards were kind of big. But I mean, they still might be. I don't know. I just don't really pay much attention to sketch cards. But that was a market I found. And so I drew sketch cards and I drew, like, movie-type art. If you go to, like, my website, jefflafferty.net, you can kind of see my early work. And that was what I was selling on eBay. So I would draw pictures of, you know, Star Wars stuff or Yoda and things like that. And then there was just a real market for that. You know, people would be searching for these sketch cards. And, you know, I just kind of followed what the other sketch card guys were doing. So, like, when they'd all be doing Star Wars sets, I'd be doing my own Star Wars cards and selling them. Or if they were doing Lord of the Rings, I would do Lord of the Rings stuff. Mm-hmm. And that was the beginnings of it. And then, like I said, you know, it just, like, from that came customers for commissions and stuff. And then that kind of just has grown over the years. But then, like, when I went and I started wanting to do comics, it was kind of hard to switch over. But I just kind of followed that same, like, system, you know. Like, I had built up the YouTube channel and, you know, I just put, you know, I just draw my comics on, you know, on video, and I put my videos out and I share my stuff on Facebook and all that kind of stuff, and then, like, build that audience. And then, you know, and then I would crowdfund it. I'd go to, like with my comic, went to Indiegogo and crowdfunded the Berserkernaut. So I think it is slow going, but it's like, you know,
if you start, you build it, they will come.
That's right. Yeah. I think a lot of the people that kind of sit around and complain about it, they don't do that, you know. They're not moving forward with that, so they don't get any traction. But
well, it's easy to sell a couple pieces and back away.
It is. Yeah.
It's really easy to do. Do it all the time.
I think that, yeah, if you're selling, like, the originals and stuff on eBay, that's, I think, a big key, is to come back every week. Because once you, like, I mean, just think of it in these kinds of terms. Like, if you do something that sells, it would be nice when that thing sells, if that customer that just bought that, whatever it was, like, you know, Yoda painting or something, clicks on your name, and then there's, like, a couple more paintings there for sale, you know. If you sell, like, that Yoda, or, you know, just an example, a Yoda, and then you don't put anything up for 2 months, that customer's long gone. So he's definitely not going to buy anything, and you're starting from zero again. But if you have stuff up every time, you know, you sell something, then it kind of gives more options. And also, he said somewhere, do you sell prints or originals? Like, I was selling originals, but then I'd make prints of the originals I'd sell and I'd put them up. Like, that's, like, if you go to my eBay right now, which is kind of down in the description, you can see a lot of the prints I sell. And, you know, all those were originals I've sold, either as commissions or prints. But, you know, the good ones, I make prints and I sell prints. And then, you know, that drives up the price of those originals. So, you know, if you sell a piece for $200 and then you sell, you know, 50 prints over the next year or so, then you've made like a ton more on that piece, you know. So I find it hard to give my originals away, or at least the right price. Yeah, I can see that. I commented, you guys able to draw and film like this because I never have a plan, so I'm all over the place and I'll draw nonstop till I ruin a piece. Yeah.
Oh man, I'm back. So did you read Tim's yet?
I'm sorry.
What'd you say? Max. He's talking about Max, the Colin character.
I don't know anything about this Max thing you talk about, but I got all this weird stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a cool cartoon too on MTV back in the day.
Oh hell yeah, I love Max.
Yeah. But I don't know nothing about the Max, bro. That's the pit.
Nah. Yeah.
Like 34 or something.
Yeah.
The originals, the texture that he's got on it. I think he uses like cheesecloth or something. Have you there's one of them, it's one of the big pinups. It looks like there's like gauze or cheesecloth or something like that. It's like somehow in the paint. Exactly. Yeah.
I think he did do a lot of kind of mixed media stuff, so maybe there's some stuff where he glued in some.
Yeah.
You know. Have you ever gone to the Troutiverse stuff? He's got what's it called? Something the Troutiverse. I think it's like a blog page he does, and he posts art on that thing. And man, he is still killing it, dude.
Does he still post on there? I remember following that, but
the Troutiverse. I'm gonna go there right now.
Yeah, I thought he kind of quit because I kind of lost track of that. But yeah, he used to really post some cool stuff he was working on. Do you worry about copyrights? Yeah, sure. You know, I don't know. It just depends on what you're going to do. It's like I get the copyright question all the time from like other artists, you know. I never get it from any real customers. But like artists worry about copyrights. So, I mean, you know.
Tuesday, December 22nd, last post.
I always thought copyright works if you create something, it's like automatically copyrighted, like giving birth to the creation. It's yours. Yeah. I thought that's how it worked.
Legally, there's more. Now, am I wrong about this, Jeff? That they have a harder time slamming you for original trademark material. But if you make a print of that original trademarked material, then they've got an issue. Am I wrong about that? Draw Batman. That's fine and dandy. You sell it. It's a one-off, fine and dandy. You make prints of that Batman and you sell it, then they get pissy. No?
It's such a gray area. I mean, but
depends like, how much it, I guess.
You guys are all like kind of talking about different things. Like what you just said there, Nate, about... Like when you copy or you create something, you are actually right about that. And it's like the second you publish that or you put it on the web or you put that into, you know, some sort of distribution kind of situation, which is just posting on the web, that actually is copyrighted to you. Like that's at that moment, you know, so you don't actually have to go out and get copyrighted. But like what Jib's talking about is like when you're doing
another character. Yeah,
exactly. If you paint Batman, are you, you know, violating the copyright on Batman if you're selling it or doing it? And I mean, in theory, yeah, it's like if you paint Batman, no one's supposed to be doing that because you are violating copyright. If you sell it online, you're not supposed to do that. And but it is still a gray area that has, you know, a lot to do with like what happens when you get to the court, because there's all sorts of cases where it's like a freedom of speech thing too, you know, which, you know, I mean, it might sound crazy, but it's really true. Like there's this case with Tiger Woods where there was a sports artist, I can't remember what his name is. And Tiger Woods sued him for painting him playing at the Masters, you know, and that's like a sports artist is what this guy does. And so they went to court and fought it out, and the artist won. And it was basically because they were saying, and it wasn't even on the original. This was on prints, because he had like these really expensive prints that were like $500 a piece or something. Whoa. And then that's what they pretty much said, like, you know, you're infringing on this guy's like freedom of speech. Now, by the same token, like, you remember like when Obama was running for president and there was like the face with there was like red and blue or whatever, or white and red, or remember that? It was just like everywhere. Mm-hmm. Some pop artist guy or that. Some. Well, yeah, I mean, you probably.
Oh, okay. Like, yeah, I think I do actually.
Yeah. Yeah. And it was really popular. And so anyway, this, some guy painted it and created it. And then he said that he took that photo off of some, you know, photo that this press agent guy took. Mm-hmm. He took him to court. And now to me, like, that's massively changed. You know what I mean? That doesn't look anything like the guy's photo he took. And yeah, that guy sued him. And then he freaking lost. Wow. The artist lost. Now, whether like, he could have, yeah.
You said it's like pop art?
Well, yeah, it's kind of like pop art. I
can Elijah's saying it's Shepherd Fairey. So is it Obey that did it?
I can't remember his name.
Is he a graffiti artist?
Maybe. I'll pull Obey. It up and then you can see.
That is Shepherd Fairey, right? It is Obey, I think.
Just 1 second. Maybe I don't know. What was that? Maybe you should look it up.
It is him.
Yeah. Well, Elijah said the same.
Shepherd Fairey is Obey. So
it's this thing right here. Share screen.
Let's see it.
So oh, yeah, I've seen that. Yeah, yeah. I didn't know who did it though.
Yeah, yeah, I didn't either. And you know, but I mean, to me, like, you know, so a lot has to do with like the court thing, but like to me, you know, like with my take on it is, you know, like I get, I don't know, like just as an artist, like I'm not selling like photos I'm taking from some movie poster or something. You know what I mean? This is like stuff I'm creating, so like I guess I don't really care, you know, that I'm breaking the law or something. I'm just gonna make my art and sell it. So you know. I know artists don't like that answer. They like want me to go like, I want you to give me permission to do whatever. I can't do that. It's all a gray area. You know, if you want to do something, you should do it. And you know, I don't know. Exactly. And I've had stuff pulled off of Etsy.
Give me, you know,
and, stuff like that. But, you know, do I feel like I'm breaking the law? No. But, you know, but would I go to the court and like fight it out with somebody? I doubt it. I'd probably just take it down, you know. So I don't know. I'm not a good guy to ask, you know.
Well, yeah,
I think it should be.
All right, Jeff.
What did you say, Jeff?
But how did Stormy go? They told you to take it down. You told them what to piss off, and they banned you.
Really?
Yeah, that is how I lost my Stormy. Stormy told me to take down a piece, and then I decided to argue with them, and so then they just took my whole store away.
Wow.
But then I just went over, I loaded all that stuff up on Etsy and, you know, just kept selling on eBay, and it's never really affected me. So, and you know, the thing about the Store Envy thing is like, I mean, they just did it because they got a letter from some lawyer. I mean, it wasn't like some court case was, you know, settled against me and all this kind of stuff.
Well, they do. And that's another thing, is they flex with those lawyer letters. That's like they think, you know. And you know, the truth of the matter is, when you tell one of those guys, you say, and take me to court, bro. And 9 times out of 10, they probably ain't going to, because there's too much money in the courts. You know, they're going to have to.
Oh, yeah. They're going to mess around and, yeah, drag me into court over $150 on eBay. Give me a break. You know, I mean, that's like the other side of it. It's like, you seriously think I'm going to be like freaking hauled in front of like the Supreme Court and made an example of it? I don't think so.
Over that, this little bit.
Yeah. That's way bigger fish to fry.
This should be a most legal things have like a monetary amount, right? It should have. Anyway, we're like a set amount. Like if you make this much more than that, then, you know, then you should be penalized. Like if you make, I don't know,
right,
say over $5,000 or something, off of an idea or concept that's not yours, then it's should be, you know, possibly copied.
But, you know, but there's I mean, I don't know. There's skewed ways to look at that stuff because I feel in my mind, I've paid enough money to Spider-Man to be able to make a little bit of money off that motherfucker. I have paid into Spider. I mean, come on, man.
Yeah.
I paid into, you know, it's like how many people have paid into that Disney Mickey Mouse, man? It's like, fuck, you should be able to draw make a damn dollar off of it. It's like, it's you're not getting in the way of their
it's
millions.
Like holding stuck.
Yeah.
You're actually promoting the shit out of it, really. You put that stuff out there.
And it's like, exactly.
A lot, and let's be real, it's like, maybe I'm wrong to say this, but like when you're doing the fan art game, it's like you need to be drawing like, well, you, I mean, you can draw pretty much anything, but if you draw what's hot, it's almost guaranteed to sell. It's like motherfuckers should have been cranking out Baby Yodas this whole time. Yeah. They've been selling. Guess, you know, the series is going to end. Is Baby Yoda going to be hot next year? Not if he's not in another show. You know, I mean, you'd be able to sell one here and there, but they're not going to fly off the shelves like pancakes right now out of IHOP. So,
probably. You know, I noticed your Randy, who's like, you know, kind of does a lot of the same sort of art as I used to do. He says, I've only had one original ever taken down off of eBay. Yeah. I agree with you. And, you know, like, I think that's the thing, too, is it's just like, that's the one bit about it that like over the years I've kind of like kind of come back is like when you do the fan art thing, you know, you are just you're promoting like those kinds of IPs, you know, you're not promoting your own stuff. So in a way you're kind of like building a little bit of a house of cards, you know what I mean, where you're not building your own stuff, you know, you're not building your own castle brick by brick, you know what I mean, you're kind of just squatting in somebody else's castle, you know what I mean?
And
you know, it's not like that's in my, you know, it's like the quick money thing, the quick money instead of like the playing like the long game, whereas like if you're building your own sort of like ideas or your own comic or something like that, it's you know, it's more of a stable foundation, you know what I mean? Because you don't know, like, if you know eBay decides tomorrow all the fan art needs to come down, then you know, then you're done.
Yeah.
Or, you know what I mean? It's the same thing with like YouTube, you know, YouTube's so crazy. I wouldn't want to put all my eggs in the YouTube basket because, you know, you just never know what's going to happen, you know?
True. Yeah.
Nobody can come along and say, hey, Jeff, you can't draw the Berserker on, you know?
You've already told me. I've seen your renditions are horrible.
Well, yeah.
He didn't say that.
No.
Never talked to Jeff behind the camera, Nate.
Okay.
I'm just joking. He don't.
Nate knows what a good guy I am. He's shut up.
I think so far, what I've seen, everybody's pretty upstanding. Everybody seems to be.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, everybody. Yeah, everybody in here is going to be cool.
So Randy says a cease and desist comes first, and then a lawsuit, and that's very true. A cease and desist is not a lawsuit; it's pretty much a threat. You know, it's a threatening
warning,
threatening the lawsuit.
Exactly. Anyway, Tim says I have the same figure of Max. I love him as a kid and still do. Wish I had some comics though. Yeah, they're all over eBay.
That's what I want to know. That next Tim comment, is that true?
I'm Jeff's brother. It could be. I do have a brother named Tim, so unless it's a troll.
This is a troll that he just knows.
It's hard to say.
Well, if I was your brother, I'd be on here just trolling anyway. I'd be trolling you anyway. So
does he want to come on? It's getting late though. I don't know. I should have him come on. It'd be fun.
It's 2:24 a.m. here. So
Lordy. I'm keeping him late.
It's late. Yeah.
The chat is like so bombing though. I don't know how we can stop.
Oh man.
Where's Frank at?
I know.
Go ahead.
Frank is not here.
You know what? Let me guess. He's Frank is giving presents to an orphanage right now. That's something nice.
He could be. You never know.
Yeah.
I don't know. He does a lot of volunteer work like that. Seems like.
I don't know what he's doing hanging out with us ruffians. Or at least me. I'm a bad
guy. It's the art, you know?
Yeah. I bet, yeah, Frank probably is doing something like that. And you were busting at him.
I'm busting him. I'm not saying good things about him. And I'm sorry, the a-hole Frank. On the show. Man, dang. What's wrong with y'all?
If Frank wants to play, I just wanted to know Jeb did all this. He was saying everything, not me.
Oh, yeah. We all know who I am. I just laid out on the line.
Yeah, art was built off stealing. I don't know.
I don't know about that. Point. Well, you know what's the difference? Inspiration and stealing. I mean, it's kind of same word a little bit there. You know, I'm inspired to do that, so I drew something like it. It's like, well, no, you stole it. Well, that's kind of what you said.
Yeah, I agree.
All right, you say stolen.
I mean, if you look at a lot of great ideas, like I believe Aliens, like the guy got it off of like what was that? He got some off of the Geiger.
H.R. Geiger, that's all. Yeah, well, he designed the aliens. H.R. Geiger, they paid him to design all that stuff.
They did. Okay.
The brainchild Geiger. They looked at his art and they said, that's the guy we want doing the concept art for this movie.
I saw Star Wars. They got some stuff off Mobius.
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah,
sure. Well, yeah. I'm going to pull Max's book back out. How can you look at this book and not see Frank Frazetta in that?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But you know, but I mean, I'm not hating on it. It's still
Sam the cat and spear, the woman. Yeah.
Yeah. That woman and spear, you know, Julie. Yeah, I mean, it's straight. That's with the thick thighs. You know, it's Frazetta, you know. I mean, nothing wrong with that. I mean, dude, a lot of us are trying to bite Frazetta. So I'm better than
others. I mean, he's a genius. I mean,
yeah. Good.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of other ones too. I mean, it's like how many Jim Lee wannabes are out there, you know?
Oh, I know. Especially back in the 90s. They were like every other artist.
Yeah. Yeah. I like his art then better than his art now. I don't know if something, it doesn't have the energy or the, I don't know, something about it now. It doesn't feel the same. It seems more like I don't know.
Yeah, I don't want to bust on him, but it does seem almost like a little bit of a more generic style of Jim Lee's art.
I always felt that way about Jim Lee. I felt like he was very good at drawing the comic book style. You know what I'm saying? That's what I felt. But then people like Sam Keith and those guys, I felt, man, those dudes are just like Jim Lee's a comic book artist. Sam Keith to me is an artist.
You know? Just an artist. Yeah.
He could be putting things, he could just be doing shows. You know what I'm saying?
Same thing with Bisley.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Same. I hope to have Jim Lee come on the show one of these days, but I guess that's over. Okay, go ahead.
Over now.
Hey. Here's the way I look at it. If you're the type of guy that wants people to kiss your butt all the time, I wouldn't want to hang out with them anyway. You know, because they you know.
Yeah.
I kiss around here. Ain't that right, Jeff?
We are. And I've met him a couple times. He's a real nice guy.
You met Jim?
Yeah, a few times out in like San Diego back in the day and stuff. And he always was like cool. We're all standing on the shoulder of giants, says Elijah. And then Art of Reed said, study the masters. I think that's like the perfect way to sum it up. You know?
Yeah, for sure. That's for sure.
Yeah.
That guy's pretty good, isn't he? The Art of Reed. Wasn't he on the show one time? And he was showing one of his books or something?
I don't know.
I can't remember.
Because when people come now on the show, they don't all go by their name, Nate, and it makes things confusing for me sometimes.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I'm not good with names anyway.
I got this crazy ass handle. Yeah, man, and I'm not good with names. You figure I would be wanting people to be able to say my name right, but then you got people like
Jeff over here. I got a question because sometimes you say Jib and sometimes you say Gib.
It's Gib. Jeff called me Jib, and I just let it ride.
Okay.
He knows my name. But he likes to call me Jib.
Wait a minute. What? Your name Shut is what?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know I don't better. Do that.
You know better.
CB Smallwood. Whenever I start working on Groon, I was thinking a lot about incorporating a lot of Sam Keith, Sean Gordon Murphy, and Mike Mignola. I mentioned this since we're talking Max and whatnot.
Yeah, do it, man. I love Sam, dude, for real.
I'm sorry, Jib. I'll make sure I pronounce your name right.
As you just said it wrong right there. I'm sorry, Jib.
What did I just say?
You said it perfect. Perfect.
Isn't your name Gibran?
No, you know better. You know better. It's all good.
I tried to pronounce your name right, and you got me so messed up on that show, I couldn't even hardly talk. So,
I've been living with this thing my whole life, and you think Jib.
Where's that name come from? I don't think I've met anybody else named Jib.
Okay, hey, their name is pronounced.
Yeah, you got me.
I'm in Texas. It's called Gibran. I'm named after a poet by the name of Khalil Gibran. He wrote a book called The Prophet.
That's so cool.
Yeah, it wasn't cool in elementary school when I was called Gilbert.
Gilbert? It's not.
Yeah, well, I don't. There's no. Yeah, I don't.
Ain't no L in there.
You telling me? You talking? Yeah. Neighbor that I live that I grew up next to my whole life called Gilbert. You know what I did?
Oh man,
I waved. I was like, "Oh, hi, how you doing?" Yeah. Fucking bitch.
A lot of people that when they do stuff like that, it don't really do no good to correct them.
Nah,
really. No. It seems like
it's like correcting Geff over here.
Yeah. Geff.
That's right. That's how you say that, right? Geff. Geff. Okay, I got that right. Right. Oh man, I'm gonna start spilling the beans on you.
I gotta be honest. He's known about Mike Mignola. I first saw his work, I really didn't like Mike's.
I don't like work. Mike Mignola's work either. Yeah,
what?
Yeah,
that's about Mike Mignola.
I don't like his work.
Some of it,
it's like yes, next no, week.
Oh, yeah,
good. No, go ahead.
Hey. I like what I like. I don't like what I don't like. So
yeah, I feel you. I do that the same way. It's like I feel like the Hellboy stuff. Like, that's Mac Mignola, right? Hellboy.
Yeah.
Plain and very geometrically shaped, and it's all right. Don't get me wrong.
It's QB, isn't it? It's Bucky. Yeah. But I mean, you can tell he does have a good understanding. I think he just I just don't like that style. I feel like he doesn't have to draw like that. He just chooses. It apparently works in marketing, I first saw his work in Cable.
Yeah, he was definitely changed his style over the years. Like, you go back before Hellboy and, in the beginnings, he was really just like your average Marvel Comics guy. Looked like everybody else. But yeah, over time, he got that real dark light style. But I personally really like his.
Oh, so what was some of the first? Was
like, well, Rocket Raccoon was, I think his first book ever. But then there's a whole bunch of books he worked on.
Okay, yeah, I have to check that out.
That old? How old? Like, when did that come out?
And like he was working at Marvel for years. Yeah, like all through the 90s and stuff. So his older stuff was more traditional. Randy says.
I have to check that out. I just saw I think X-Force was the first thing I saw that he did. And his Cable, it looked weird to me. So,
Mignola did? I mean, you're not talking about Rob Liefeld, are you?
Yeah, Liefeld, I thought he did all that.
No, I'm pretty sure it was him. I'll have to...
I don't know. Like I said, dude, I'm like a Sam Keith junkie and I'm fucking busy. I'm into those dudes. I'm into that. I like all that blown out stuff, But I don't know. I like that,
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I love that stuff.
Yeah,
Yeah.
Sorry. You can tell I'm in this.
I like that Wolverine. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Maybe he did do some, Cable stuff. I was just looking. Whoops. Let me share my screen again. I've never seen this stuff.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Oh,
whoa. Yeah, no. Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's pretty cool. I don't know. I've always
been okay. A fan
Yeah. Yeah. I think me and Nate feel about the same way about that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, man. Stuff's cool. Like, a
What do you think? What do y'all think of Rob Liefeld?
I'm not.
I like Rob.
I dare you.
I like Rob. Yeah.
You don't like Rob's work, Jeff?
No, nah, I can't, you know, even lie about it. I've never really dug his stuff.
Okay.
I like some of his stuff. I mean, he's definitely drawn some stuff that had some problems before, like, you know, the Captain America with the fucking chest opening up like a refrigerator.
Yeah. It seems like the stuff that he did, it was not any good, was rushed. It's like he tried to do it too fast, too much to meet the deadline. It wasn't quality, but he's capable. I feel like he was capable of doing, you know, pretty good work.
Yeah, I think, yeah.
It's different. The style is different.
Right. The stuff you see posted around the web, you know, I think, you know, of course they're going to go find the absolute worst panel.
The worst. You see the, yeah, they show the worst. Yeah.
But, you know, it's just,
I mean, he's
know.
Not my favorite. He's yeah. not my favorite, but I do like some of his work. Yeah.
Yeah. That's some stuff I'm into, man. Rob Liefeld. But yeah, I feel you.
On Wolverine, I would say my favorite artist was Mark, I don't know, Texera, something like that.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
Texera.
Yeah.
Or that's how I always say that.
Yeah.
You're looking at
my I don't know. Wolverine it's a different name. So
I am
who's that one right there? Is that Sam Keith? That's what I'm going to say.
Yeah, I'm going to say he has that Max kind of feel to it. And these are all Sam Keith. And then on the other side, I want to say the back of these have Wolverine, or not Wolverine, Ghost Rider and Cable. Yeah.
Yeah. Sam Keith likes his triceps, don't he? All his triceps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, huge. He has all that crazy stuff. He's like he loves that cross hatching, man. I love it.
Yeah.
He likes to get in there and crosshatch all that stuff.
So, that's a cool Texera piece right there. I was trying to find some like more, you know.
Yeah, I forgot I had bought these.
Oh, this classic stuff, but I can't really.
Oh, those are cool though. I don't know if I've seen any of this, or just didn't pay attention to it.
That could be him.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's got that's crazy good. Style.
Yeah.
I like this stuff a lot.
Got a lot of white highlights in the hair. Ooh, what's going on here?
Tim says that troll been watching you guys for a long time under different names. But Jeff bought me the Max character as a kid, and I hope I can draw with you guys in the future. Well, that'd be awesome.
For sure, man.
Heck yeah.
Don't let Jeff say no.
Well, Randy's telling me to get me a Superman 18. I don't know, Superman 18. I'm guessing Mike did that, or what?
I don't know, Mike.
Because we was talking about.
That other dude, would you say his name was Texera? How did he say his name?
Superman 18. Yeah. No, I don't. I don't know. Magnolia, maybe.
Oh. Yeah, I don't like Superman. I just don't like Superman. Yeah. He just seemed too. Well, I guess a lot of superheroes are kind of like set up like as a god type. Character, but I would rather kill Superman. And I thought, you know, they come up with so many fantastic inventions that, you know, don't exist, like nano machines and stuff. Why don't you just get some, you know, kryptonite dust and put it in nano machines, you know, and throw a cloud, a, you know, grenade or something that blows up in a cloud, and then he breathes it in and they dissolve him and eat him up from the inside and nothing left.
Right.
He'd be easy to kill, you know?
Yeah. I think that's the one he's talking about.
Mark Barr property. Thanks, Nate.
Superman 18. Yeah. Looks like it was Magnolia that did it. I've never seen this either. That looks interesting.
Weird. Yeah. What is
going on? I've never been like.
Dude, that looks strange to me.
Yeah.
I mean, not that I'm doing great stuff, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I'm all right.
Yeah, he had a lot of very different, but you all gotta like Conan says.
Oh hell yeah, bro.
Oh yeah, Conan's. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's like yes.
Everyone should give Magnolia, Second Look. His layout, storytelling, and use of shadows is top notch. Yeah,
everybody
Go ahead. Yeah, I was going to say, I think that Magnolia is almost kind of like a Jack Kirby kind of thing, where it's like you either love him or hate him. I mean, I personally love him, and I love Kirby too, but I've definitely met people who, you know, just can't stand him. So,
yeah, Kirby's one of those guys that it's like when I got older, I started liking Kirby stuff. You know, I kind of realized who he was and really got into into more of what he did and could enjoy it more. But as a kid, you know, I was just like, what? No, I don't want this.
It's kind of blocky. Kirby's blocky, but.
I thought he was like a young artist when I first came across him as a kid. I thought he was like a younger artist that wasn't quite as good as like the other artists, which is horrible to say. But I don't know. I've really got an appreciation for his work now, though.
To me, I see his work as like one of those things, like the work itself overall. I don't like the style, but style is like clothes, you know? That's the service. What he's capable of as an artist, I think exceeds that. I think what he's capable of is way better than what he put in a production value, you know? And that's what a lot of his comedy, I mean, he cranked out lots of volume
back in the day.
So
for sure.
I'd say he's still got a lot of records that probably never will be broke, you know? And volume. So
I follow, like there's kind of a couple of Jack Kirby pages on Instagram where they just kind of post like old Jack Kirby stuff. And, you know, it always amazes me what they post, like stuff I've never seen, you know, like ever. And, you know,
that but actually this, isn't too bad. That's Mike Manoa. Yeah.
Where are we at?
That's not too bad.
I was looking at this. No, I don't like it at all.
That
you don't like it at all.
Randy told me to pull that up.
No, I know. I'm looking at. I was looking at in the background. I was fixing to have you pull it up. Like, there's a couple of
the skeletons are done well, though.
Yep. There's a like I was digging through the pages of it, and I don't know, man. It's like I think one of my things I don't like
about. Oh, you don't like the internal work?
Not at all. The shadows in some of these, it's like you're so deep in the shadows in some areas, and in some areas no shadows at all. And it just throws me off. I think that's what throws me off with the pieces. And then sometimes,
bad contrast.
And sometimes I don't feel he's, and maybe it's just me, but sometimes I feel he's not putting the shadows where they go. That's not where the shadows go. What are you doing? It looks wrong to me. Maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm the fool, but it's not a
big Joe Kubert said, if it looks wrong, it is.
I think it was Simon Bisley said, when in doubt, black it out.
Black it out.
So maybe that's where he's going with that.
So Frank Miller does that too. He blacks it out. He blacks out a lot. He's good with the darks and lights though.
Yeah. So Tuan or something. That's some eccentric art style, Randy. So
Tuanan Bui.
Yeah.
He's saying
Conan is perfect too. I agree. Like it just depends. Like, I mean, there's just been, you know, some great artists and that I love, but then, you know, some of the newer Conan stuff I've seen Marvel putting out, I just have not really been able to get into just because of the art, but
those new ones.
Is that John Buscema?
I'm not sure if all this is, but some of it is. Yeah. These are like,
those are the reprints.
The reprints, when they reprint. I don't have like any of the Savage Sword stuff. Wish I did.
Well, not everybody except Social Justice Warriors like Conan. I think everybody except for Social Justice Warriors loves Conan.
I heard that wrong. I thought you said, I think all Social Justice Warriors like Conan. I was like, whoa, man.
Social Justice Warriors should love Conan.
Everyone should love Conan.
Yeah.
The embodiment of testosterone. Just kicking ass and taking names.
Yeah.
But I mean, like a lot of those early Savage, not even early, for like a lot of the run, like those Buscema, Conan's, man, that stuff is so good.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude, for sure.
I really think almost unequaled, you know, like, you know, you look at like modern comics, like he was also, CB was mentioning Sean Gordon Murphy, which I've been following him on Instagram. And it's funny, like he's got some really cool stuff too, but it, then I noticed like, and I don't want to bust on anybody, but that's like one where I kind of, I don't know. I don't really like a lot of his interior work. It's almost very like simple marble type stuff that, you know, that Sean Gordon Murphy.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I've not paid much attention to his work. I probably
think
he's been spitting his name out a lot.
Yeah. I was digging it when I saw like the Batman and all the motorcycles and stuff. And I was like, holy shit, this guy's awesome. But then like, I don't know, like I've been kind of following, you know, him on Instagram and he just posts his new stuff and, like some of that stuff, it just seems almost kind of generic. I don't know if he's just kind of going fast or what, but I don't know. I don't like talking this way about current artists because, you know, I don't want to insult people.
Well, you're just saying what you like, and that's just your opinion. Everybody's got their own opinion. I'm sure there's artists that he don't like. I don't know if people are going to say what they like or what they don't like openly, but I feel like everybody should, you know, where you stand with people, you know. And it's not necessarily personal. If you don't like something, it's not necessarily personal. You know, just I just don't like it. If I don't like it,
yeah,
it's not. You know, you can, you know, don't like their work, but them as a person, you know, they're cool or whatever. So
I like work, Jeff. I'm just not sure about you as a person yet, though.
Yeah.
Well, we'll see how this works out. I'll figure that out once Tim's on the show.
Yeah, really. I know he'll just fucking like all my dirty secrets, man.
Yeah, I need to talk with him.
See, like this is that Sean Gordon Murphy. Like,
oh, see, that's fire, though. I think.
Yeah,
I like that.
This is like the stuff I saw in the beginning, and I was like, "Holy shit! Look at this guy."
The only thing I don't like is the pose, the Batman pose.
I know it's kind of weird. I just got to
see it. Yeah.
And then
that leg, that straight arm.
Yeah.
Wonder Woman's butt could be bigger. I mean,
the perspective is really good.
Yeah.
Everything, the placement of objects, it's got depth, everything.
That's good. And
these like motorcycles are like, holy shit, man. So awesome.
Let me show you what Batman's supposed to be driving, though, guys. He ain't supposed to be driving that. We looked at this yesterday, the other day. Me and you, Jeff. That's a Batmobile, people.
Oh, yeah. That was a neat one.
That thing is out of control.
That's a good comic, though. Yeah. I wonder how long it took him to do that. The whole comic. It's like 60 something pages, isn't it?
Yeah. You got me counting pages. But I think it is. It's
definitely. Bisley's like pretty notoriously fast, though.
Yeah.
You know?
But that painting, though, how do you do that fast?
I don't know. Like, but
he's got it, you know, he's got it all broken down into like steps.
And I wonder what scale he's working at. If you're working big, that.
Yeah,
that's crazy, man.
Batman right there is fire too. Oh, I'm sorry, I'll put these up.
But most of the stuff I've seen from his stuff, like when I've seen originals, they are like the usual like 10x15 comic, like standard comic size most of the time. So
yeah,
if you go to his YouTube page though, he did that huge Joker like almost 10 years ago now. That thing is huge. And then also before you read that. On his Instagram page, he just put out like a new Lobo pen and ink picture that is dope, man. It is dope. I wonder if I can find
it. Who is he talking?
Yeah, I'm going to dig it up right now.
Yeah.
Who's Twan talking about? Bending bars?
I don't know. There's no way that man can bend steel bars without 5 pounds of rib.
Oh, they're talking about Vegan Conan that Brandy was talking about. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. I get it. The current Marvel Conan. But see, that's the thing, though. I personally don't really like the way Marvel's doing Conan right now. Like, I'm not digging on the art. And then also sticking him in the like Avengers. To me, it just don't fit, dude. But, you know.
Yeah.
So, but that's just my opinion. So, you know.
I agree. Yeah.
I'm not really digging on much Marvel's doing anymore, but, you know.
I don't think most people are, to be perfectly honest.
Yeah.
I don't think, especially the large, you know, the core audience. comic book people, you know.
Mm-hmm. Love the King Conan storyline, though. Is that one of the new ones that's coming out? Website. All right. Well, it hasn't come over yet. But... Yeah. I don't know. I liked, and I'm not sure which ones. But I don't, you know, since I moved, they're kind of like not around my table right now. But there was one I was reading, and it was like Conan, like, you know, in the old days or whatever, and he's fighting some witch with these weirdo kids who are after him. That one was pretty cool. But then when the Conan the Avengers thing was just like, ugh.
I can't show
it. It was coming through. Put that back up there. I might be able to pull it up. What is it on Bisley's
thing? It's like Lobo. He's in space on his motorcycle.
Yeah, we got dog on the side here flipping the bird. Really cool, man. I don't know.
Is that just ink or is it colored with black and white?
I think it was inked. I think it's the same ink. Oh, yeah, it's got a little bit of gray tone in it.
Yeah.
I think it'd be nice to see painted. I don't
know. Here, I got it here.
Okay. See, that's okay. It came up a little bit bigger. But easy.
Yeah, it can't make it quite.
You can't. But, see, the problem is when you pull up your computer, you can't pull up the second picture.
There's like a second one. Yeah.
All good. But yeah.
I don't think he likes cross hatching.
He just likes to get
squirted. He doesn't use cross hatching very much, does he?
No, he don't do very smooth lines either, and I love it.
It's more organic.
I agree. It's almost like he's lost or doesn't do. That one was a really cool one too, right there.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't do it as much anymore.
I want to say he either ran a crowdfunder or was running one or is right now for
that.
Something broke the Gladiator of Brooklyn. It was just a scroll to it.
Yeah, he did. Actually, here's the thing right here. It's his last day. I remember when he did this. And I totally didn't go and check out what it was, which is super lame. Wonder where the link is to this thing.
Let's see if I can find it real quick right
now. So it says Kickstarter, not Indiegogo.
It was on Kickstarter.
Because he's not Comicsgate. Doesn't want to associate with you guys, so I get your hopes up.
Hey, pull that back.
Yeah. What'd you say?
Pull that Bisley page up. He's painting a Ninja Turtle thing in here, dude. Holy shit. Maybe watching
that. Yeah, where? Oh, in this video thing?
Indiegogo. If you scroll down a couple, that he's like painting a Ninja Turtle piece that is like fire.
Are you talking to me and what I'm showing, or?
I don't think you're not showing anything.
No, he's looking at it on his Instagram, or not his? Is it? Oh, okay. Instagram.
Yeah, it's Instagram. He's painting this thing.
Yeah.
Is that on that same page?
Yeah, it's on his page. You can open it up. I wonder how long he paints on this thing. That's for a couple of minutes. It looks like.
So he does. Starts out with thin washes, and just layers it up.
Yeah. Thicker and thicker. That's what I believe. And I love his work though, man. So cool. Yeah. And you can look at that table he's painting on or palette or whatever the hell.
Oh, there it is. Okay.
That's what's up, man. Yeah, there he is.
Yeah, it's kind of like
God, I don't feel bad about my little art area anymore.
It's
worse than mine. See, I got a problem where when the acrylic gets like that, I want to like scratch it off of my finger. It's like part of the fun.
Oh yeah, that's what I do on my palettes when they get real thick. I just peel them. So I use like a plastic lid type thing for them now. Oh yeah, Art of Reed said the Corey Nord's run on Conan was epic. I agree. I love Corey Nord's work, and he is awesome. I wish he'd be on a fucking comic again. I don't know what the guy's doing.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, man, Marvel fucking ditched him or whatever. I guess that was Dark Horse back then, but I haven't seen that dude on anything for like so long. Anyway, Frank Rosetta.
How long is that video there?
Cut Your Soil. Looks like about 2 minutes.
Yeah.
2 minutes. Yeah. I'll check that out later.
Oh, you can write it, does Tim?
Yeah, we should actually probably
end it.
Jump off.
Oh man, we're like 30 minutes over. Look at you, Nate.
Poor old.
Yeah. Oh, is that me?
I got to blame somebody. I'm blaming you.
I know. Nate comes on the show, he just like takes it over.
All right.
No.
Well, yeah, you took over the show, Nate. It's no problem. Now, I want to throw it out there, though, that Berserker Night is still live on Indiegogo. You can pick it up. It's in demand. Also, Kill Reaver is in demand on Indiegogo. I believe we probably ain't going to be on for the rest of the week, so this is going to be the only show for the week. Am I correct, Jeff?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, because
I was reading.
We're usually off on Wednesdays, and then Thursdays and Fridays will be Christmas Eve and Christmas. So we'll probably see you again on Monday. Anything else that we normally are pushing? You know, Country Fried Doom Chicken. It's illegal.
What about Nate? Do you want to share a website or anything? Or like, where do you?
We share.
Yeah, where do you post Instagram? Your art? Instagram? Okay.
Can you? You tap it in.
Sure. Do I?
You tap that in here.
I don't.
Nate underscore L underscore.
Yeah, that's
West at Instagram. Yeah.
I got it right here. I'll throw a link in the chat for you.
Okay. I ain't seen an opportunity to top here. I don't know where it's at.
It's like down at the bottom. But you might not have it just because I might be the only one that can, you know, since it's like I'm like the main show guy or whatever.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
But yeah, definitely, guys, if you're not following Nate on Instagram, go check him out at Nate underscore L.
Somebody just started following me. That was fast.
Look. Here we go. Let's show some of Nate's art.
Whoa. Yeah, go straight to it. There we go.
When did this one go up? I totally missed this, man.
Yeah, I don't remember seeing this one, dude. I would have remembered the booty.
It's been a while. It's a Betty Page pin up. You know Betty Page.
Yeah. I like that painting. Yeah, that's great. That'll probably be the thumbnail of this video right there.
Right there. You done messed up.
There we go. Is it illegal to put it on YouTube?
This is probably not. This is the one that the last one I remember seeing this little cartoon.
I don't know how many people read it though. I think it's pretty funny.
Yeah.
You want to be a manly man like me, but now you can, oldie mice.
Yeah.
Strong enough for a woman made for a man. There you go.
Yeah. That's great. Yeah, and I can't click. Oh, no, actually, I can. Yeah, he's got the whole thing on there.
I don't know if you can. It's probably too small to zoom in.
Yeah, I don't know. Insta won't let you. How do you zoom it in?
On Instagram, on my phone, I use my thumbs. I just separate it. And you got to move it over, and you do it again. It's annoying. Yeah.
John, look at you, Jeff. I didn't know you. How did you do that? I'm
And I broke it up into three, I think. That way you can.
Oh, did it? Oh, there it is. Yeah. So you can read a little closer. Yeah, but yeah, go follow him on Instagram. Go read it yourself over there, guys.
Make sure you give it a big.
Thanks, Kurt.
Love it.
Yeah.
And guys, I think that's going to end it for the night. So, Monday.
We'll see you guys. Yeah, probably Monday. Have a good Christmas, everyone.
Thanks, Nate, for coming.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
God bless everybody.